If you like the video, make sure to like, subscribe, and comment. For more videos like this.
For those who explore abandoned or haunted places, haunted forests and cabins in the woods, what are your horror stories involving the unknown? What have you encountered?
Back in my early 20s, I'm now almost 30. My best friend and I did a ton of urban exploration. Mostly old farmhouses because of the more rural area we live in. A few houses gave off some weird vibes, and we only ever had one scary experience. Until we decided to explore this house that was on a busy highway, two lanes as it's still in our rural area, we pulled to the side of the road just up from the clearly abandoned home, put on the four ways, and ran down the gravel side to the gated driveway. A small hole in the gate we pushed ourselves through. As we walk towards the side back of the house to the door not visible to the highway, we see the boarded windows and overgrown lawn and driveway, not thinking twice about it not being abandoned. I get to the screen glass door, and as I go to walk inside, I see two black shadows of what looked like an old woman who was sitting at the small kitchen table in the center of the pitch black room and a youngish man standing by the counters at the back of the kitchen. I turn to my friend and say, "Run. There are people here." As we get to the gate, I turn to see if anyone followed us out, as they clearly would have heard me yell to my friend. Nothing. So fast forward. 5 years, probably 2 years ago, from the time I'm writing this, my best friend and I are talking, and she starts telling me that an older guy we went to high school with and is friends with her parents owns that house and the land for farming. He messaged her and asked if we visited that house and trashed it. She's like, "No? There were people living there when we went." He said, "That's impossible, it's been abandoned for 40 years. When she told me this, I got chills down my spine, because what followed was that the person trashing the house was caught, and he told the owner he was trying to ruin it as it sits on the devil's land. The owner had no idea who this guy was. Who did I see that day? And are they keeping me from something more sinister inside that home? The house is still standing today, and I'm yet to go back and get my answers." At the time of this story, I was a 20-year-old female. My boyfriend and I decided to go fishing at a local pond with his friend. The location was pleasant, with little to no crime. It was nighttime in the middle of summer, probably getting close to 11 p.m. When we arrived, there were no vehicles in the small lot, just a single moped. We didn't see anyone at first, so we picked our spot close to the gravel lot. We set up our gear and began fishing with their special glow-in-the-dark bobber. At this moment I wasn't aware, but my boyfriend had spotted the presumed owner of the moped walking around the perimeter of the pond. Once he had gotten a good distance away, as the pond was a decent size, he asked me if I had seen the guy walking around by himself acting strangely. I hadn't seen him, but I was curious as to what he was doing and why he was out here, alone, so late at night. To add to this, my boyfriend also said that he was dressed in all black, more specifically, a trench coat and boots. My boyfriend's friend is the type of person that loves exploring nature and catching small animals, so after a few moments he told us that he would be back after he goes to find some frogs and turtles. I still haven't spotted the strange man that my boyfriend described, as I keep looking around and asking him, "Do you see him? Where's he at?" Probably 20 or so minutes later, his friend comes back and tells us something that was so strange I couldn't wrap my head around it. He said that when he was looking for animals, he was startled by a man who tried to scare him by yelling nonsense sounds in a way hard to describe in writing. He's obviously caught off guard and walks back to where we are. After he tells us what happened, we laugh and are just so utterly confused as to what just happened. I'm still on the lookout for the guy just because I'm curious, occasionally asking where he's at and if anyone sees him. We brush it off as much as we can, and I continue fishing. A while later, my boyfriend and his friend begin packing up. I'm just amazed with the glow-in-the-dark bobber, and I don't want to leave. I'm still asking them, "Where's that weird guy? I want to see what he looks like." Clearly, as I'm not getting the hint, my boyfriend tells me that we need to leave and to pack up my things. Of course, my bobbers are tangled at this point, and I'm standing there for what seems like forever trying to fix it before hauling it into the trunk. We finally get into the car and head home. On the way home, my boyfriend tells me something that still haunts me to this day. After the man had tried scaring our friend, he had walked all the way around the pond to where we were at. He tells me that as we were standing fishing, the man was behind us, just staring at us from about 10 feet away. Mind you, this was also while I'm being a clueless fool and asking where the weird guy was. To my ignorance, he was there the whole time. What makes it even scarier is that there was a light behind the man, so his face was completely anonymous. I'm 25 now, but this happened to me and my two best friends when we were 17-18 in our senior year of high school. My friend Sarah would spend summers with her dad in a very rural and small town, about 48 minutes away from where Katie and I lived. Katie and I decided to spend the weekend with Sarah and we're going to have some fun hiking and backyard camping, our usual teen girl shenanigans. Sarah's dad had a large plot of land with hiking trails and lots of woods to explore. The back of the plot emptied out to long decommissioned railroad tracks that ran through to the next town. We packed a satchel of snacks, filled my Camelback, and the three of us set off to walk the trails. I had my cell phone, and Sarah had a pocket knife. For three teen girls, it was better safe than sorry. Her dad knew we were going out and had my number in case we didn't come back. We walked for a bit, laughing and talking and having a good time. We made it to the train tracks and walked until we got to a bridge and decided to head back to the house. On the way back, we heard in the distance the roar of a four-wheeler engine, and it was getting closer. We rushed into the woods, hiding and staying silent. Sarah pulled her knife, and Katie and I each held a large rock. The four-wheeler slowly rolled past where we were hiding before speeding off again. We slunk out of the woods and kept walking on the tracks, scared but trying to stay calm. Only a few minutes later we heard the engine approaching from the direction that it sped off in after scanning the woods. We rushed back into the woods, hiding and more scared as they slowly rolled by again, silent except for the sound of the engine. They sped off again, and we rushed back to the house, shaken up and deciding not to tell her dad about it. I wish I had more closure. We never did find out who the person was or why they never said anything. Even looking back now, I can't help but think that whatever their intentions were, they were sinister. This is a short story that happened to me several years ago, but still affects me to this day and is something I don't think I will ever forget. School had just ended 3 weeks prior, and my friend and I were just hanging out, enjoying a surpassingly beautiful summer night. I live in a very quiet little town. There really isn't much commotion, or really much of anything that goes on. We have one main school, and our graduating class is tiny compared to most. Around midnight, we were pretty sick of playing games and wanted to do something different. He suggested walking around outside on the beautiful, clear summer night. Without much hesitation, I agreed. It was after midnight in a quiet town, and I figured not much could go wrong. My parents were asleep, but they trusted me anyway, so sneaking out just to walk probably wouldn't have been a huge issue. We ended up staying out for a couple of hours. We talked about movies, wrestling, and what our plans for the rest of the summer would be. Up to this point, it had actually been one of my favorite nights in a long time. Just to be able to enjoy the nice breeze, moonlight, and have some good old-fashioned conversation. We were already on our way back home and were probably only about 5 minutes from my house. We were walking down a very low-lit street. On the right side were some old houses, where 95% of the lights were off, and our left was just trees. My friend pointed out as we were walking that the way one of the lights was hitting the trees, it looked like a person. We laughed at first and kind of were amazed at how much it really did look like a person. But after a moment, the laughter faded away as we realized that maybe this wasn't just a shadow. So like the fools that we were, we decided to explore, and I pulled back a few branches and saw that there was actually a woman standing there. She had a huge, almost distributing smile on her face. She was old, probably in her 70s, I would guess. She was dressed normal and had lots of nice jewelry on. She looked like my grandma, who would dress for holiday parties. But the scariest part was she was just standing there like a statue, smiling at us. For a moment, we just stood there in shock. And within a split second, her smile vanished, and she jumped out and made a huge grunt and a scream. We ran as fast as we could back to the house. To my knowledge, she didn't follow us or anything else. I know most people may not find this particularly scary, but in the middle of the night, when you find a creepy old lady hiding in the trees, it rattles your cage. Nothing else of note came from this incident. But as I mentioned previously, I'll never be able to get the image of her smiling and suddenly screaming at us out of my head. When I was a kid, I used to love playing in the woods. This was because I had been born in a town next to a heavily forested area in the piney woods. Growing up, it was myself and my dad. He was a hard-working man who did his best to support his only son. Oftentimes I would be left home alone when he went off to work. Because it happened so often as the years passed, I got more used to it and didn't really mind. We had cable, but there was nothing really on that I cared to watch, so I usually spent most of my time outside in my backyard. Let me simply state that my backyard wasn't really much of a yard. There was grass, but it would immediately end, and the rest would be covered in a vast amount of trees. The houses in my neighborhood were pretty spread apart, so there weren't even fences to close off anyone's backyards. I loved those woods and spent many hours of my childhood in them. I spent so much time in them that I was familiar with certain areas that I spent period in. As time went on, I would go deeper and deeper to play and explore. There were always sounds that I heard while playing, whether it be the birds or the rustling of leaves in the wind. Oftentimes I'd hear other people talking or laughing in the distance. Every time that occurred, I would stop what I was doing and quickly try to hide from the direction the noises had been coming from. For a while, nothing of interest happened. One time I again went deep into the forest to find something to do. As I walked, I came across a small clearing surrounded by trees that were thicker than the rest. I found this place pretty interesting. An idea popped in my head, something about trying to build a small makeshift shelter made out of the natural materials around me. I think I got that idea after watching an episode of Survivor Man, one of the few TV shows that I enjoyed. Once the plan was set, I decided to return home and get some of my dad's cutting tools from the garage. After I gathered some equipment, including a hatchet, I made my way towards the construction site. While I walked, I took notice that the sky began getting a little darker as the sun started to go down. Looking down at my watch, I saw that it was 5:30. I was taken back at first because I thought it would be too late to get started on my project, but then realized that I could at least start on it a little bit before leaving. When I finally got there, I looked up and saw something that made me freeze in my tracks. A man. He wore a checkered shirt with some jeans, a camo-colored cap, and had a black bandana wrapped around his mouth. He just stood there wide-eyed and completely still, as if he had been caught in the act of something. In his hands was a shovel, and from what I could tell, he had been digging in the spot where I had planned to make my shelter. That wasn't all that I noticed. On the ground a few feet behind where the man was standing was the motionless body of a girl who looked around college age. The girl's head lay on its side and faced my direction. Her eyes looked at me, but at the same time they didn't. It's like they stared straight into the abyss as their lights went out. The man made the first move. He dropped the shovel and looked down at the body for a few seconds, then raised his head and gazed back at me. He then began to speak. "Hey kid, let's not do anything crazy. I'm not going to hurt you." He then began slowly walking my way. Instinctively, I raised the hatchet I had brought along high above my head. Without a second thought, I threw it at him, albeit way too high. He dove, and as he did, I could see the anger in his eyes. I turned and ran back towards my home as quick as I could. In the background, I could hear him chase after me by the sound of feet pounding against the dry ground and leaves being stepped on. Something else was heard that broke the repetition. A big object hit the earth. While continuing to run, I turned my head and noticed that in the distance the guy had tripped and fallen over. That didn't make me let up one bit. I continued sprinting and hopping over tree roots until I approached my house's back door. I closed it quickly and ran to the kitchen where the phone was and dialed 911. After the operator said the police would be on their way, I grabbed a kitchen knife and pinned myself in front of one of the couches whose back was facing the back door. I waited for the man to appear outside the glass sliding door, but he never came. A short time later, the cops arrived along with my dad, who had been called from work. I began bawling and explained everything that had happened. The police then scoured the woods in search of the man. They never found him, but they did discover the body of the girl that was still there. Later on, it was discovered that she was a prostitute that was hitchhiking, and the man had picked her up. After having his way with her, he tried to get rid of the evidence, which I stumbled upon. Afterwards, once this had all blown over, my dad and I moved to the next town over. To this day, I still love the great outdoors and the woods in general, but won't risk going out where I'm alone. What creeps me out is the thought that if he had finished burying the body before I showed up, I could have built a shelter right above her. Don't go to the suicide bridge. So I've always wanted to go to the suicide bridge out in Pasadena. Well, when I finally got my first car, me and two of my girlfriends went up there. All three of us are sensitive when it comes to haunted places and paranormal things, if you catch my drift. We had to park on the other side of the bridge, which meant we had to walk across the entire bridge if we wanted to explore a little bit. Our night had already started off weird. We kept seeing the same blue truck drive back and forth on the bridge, same driver, same truck. We brushed it off, but then walking along the bridge, we all got this sick feeling. I started getting anxious. I kept getting the feeling of wanting to jump off. I have been suicidal in the past, which scared me because I wanted to so badly that night. My other two friends kept feeling like someone was following them. Another scary thing, my friend had told us she had this woman spirit that had been following her for a few months, so that definitely didn't help. Finally, we reached the other side of the bridge in hopes we can actually go under, but they have fenced it off. There were a few people there already basically doing the same thing we were doing. There was a group of boys that had found a way in under the fence, so my friends and I were going to follow and do the same. For some reason, we couldn't find the area the boys went under, so we were going to go over. Almost immediately, we all hear this woman scream bloody murder. I have never seen a group of kids jump and run so fast. We're all pretty sure it was just someone telling us to get off the fence, but nonetheless, scary. Anyways, we started to head back to my car but decided to walk on the other side. The side where the lights were much more dim and the whole vibe just felt dark. We all started to feel anxious. I started to get hot, I felt like people were reaching out at us. The scariest part was when we looked over the bridge into complete darkness, and then I started to feel like I was going to vomit. My friends just wanted to leave, they definitely didn't want to be there anymore. One friend kept hearing someone or something whispering in her ear, one friend was feeling anxious and nauseous, and I was feeling sick and suicidal as duck. We finally made it back to my car, but I couldn't drive. My head was pounding, I started getting really bad cramps, I started sweating, and my vision was getting blurry. I really thought I was going to pass out, but my other friends weren't feeling sick anymore. Only me, so we had to sit there for a few minutes until my body stopped bugging out. It was definitely a scary experience. It sucked we didn't get to explore underneath the bridge, but it's also been 3 years since we first went to the suicide bridge. I'm definitely going back at some point, but I will be more prepared, especially now that I know how my body's going to react. Be careful if you're sensitive or a medium, an empath, because that bridge ducks with you. A completely abandoned prison near our house. I was absolutely warned not to go in it, it's falling apart, and the doors are probably locked anyway. It's been abandoned for almost 70 years. It's not like the asylums where you can have a guide, this place is truly abandoned. Last week I said duck it and tried for it, it's maybe 2 football fields from our house. To preface, I've been in a few abandoned hospitals, houses, etc. I treat it like camping. Leave no trace. Just go in, do a bit of exploring, and leave. I had to do it at night. If you get caught on that land, still owned by the government, you are in a lot of trouble. What I came upon while getting in there was a cemetery. Gravestones with numbers. Not just a few, hundreds. I stood there, staring at them all. I didn't use my flashlight, the moon was bright enough. Then I looked up, it was the prison, these all sat behind it. The complex was massive. I realized I was standing in the prisoner's graveyard. Now for why I was warned not to go there, aside from it being extremely illegal without clearance from the state. My stepfather refuses to go, even though if he accompanied me, it would be legal. One reason is because of the structure being unsafe, the other is that the place apparently is extremely unsettling. When I expressed interest in seeing it, those that knew of it looked at me like I was ducking crazy and asked, "Why would you want to go in there? That place is just wrong." Which only piqued my interest even more. So I went alone, at 2 a.m. it was a mistake. You see, a lot of people died in that prison. Not by state-authorized execution, they'd get beaten to death by guards, fellow inmates, and natural causes otherwise. That's why there is a cemetery. A lot of bad things happened there. A lot of people died there. I stood in the cemetery, just staring at the structure. Unironically, lightning flashed in the distance as clouds were rolling in. But it fully illuminated the place. And it was just simply vast. It's the first time I've ever felt I immediately need to leave an abandoned place. I convinced myself, I've run into junkies in these places, seen weird graffiti that would be off-putting to most, hell, I've fallen through a floor. This was not one of those places. It was untouched by vandals. It was as it had been in 1957. Mostly used by the state as storage. I walked around the complex to reach the entrance. I tried the front door. Unlocked. You have to understand all of these complexes are under lock and key, even the abandoned ones on state-owned land. I immediately felt uneasy, but I wanted to see it, so I turned on my flashlight and stupidly went inside. I do not believe in paranormal bullshit. But what I saw and heard changed most of that. There's a door to a basement cemented off once you get further in. It seems no one I've talked to knows what's there. Most likely a morgue. Maybe an infirmary. No one knows why it's been closed off, but that feeling that I needed to leave now persisted. I reasoned that the main door was unlocked, probably by an absent-minded guard or inmate on the land. Nothing felt right in there. My body screamed at me to leave. Do it now. But stupidly, I carried on. There were shackles on the walls hooked into the cement, stains I couldn't describe as not dried blood. The air was thick. That's when I heard it. The shrill scream let out from an above floor. And the noises of someone being beaten. I can 100% assure you no one else was in there, due to how remote it is, and it isn't a place vagrants show up to. I thought it was metal at first, possibly the roof falling in. Seconds later it happened again. It was human, or, at least it was. I ducking ran like the devil was on my ass. I dropped my flashlight down a flight of stairs. I freaking panicked, I didn't know the layout. I didn't know how to get out. And then there was this audience of laughter and banging against metal, like I was a show to them, whoever they are. The overhead lights began to come on, not unusual, power still ran to the place, just no one was hitting the switch. The lights died all at once. I grabbed my phone, turned on its flash, and barreled ass out of there. I made it to the main door, and it was jammed. I started to scream. I shouldered it to get through, got a few feet away, and just thought to turn around and stare at the building. It went quiet. I left as the rain started. I'll never do that again. Everyone who knew it was right. There's something extremely wrong with that place. This happened to me last year, and I still can't shake the feeling that it wasn't over. I live in a small town surrounded by dense woods. One of the local legends was about an old, abandoned house deep in those woods. Supposedly, it had been left to decay for decades and was haunted by the spirits of the family who used to live there. Typical small town ghost story, right? My friends and I, all of us around 17 to 18 years old, decided to check it out one night. It was me, Jake, Sarah, and Emily. We were bored and figured it would be fun to scare ourselves a bit. Armed with flashlights and our phones, we trekked into the woods. After about an hour of walking, we found it. The house was in ruins, but it was still standing. As soon as we got close, I felt this intense chill. It wasn't just cool night air, it was something deeper, something that made the hairs on my arm stand up. We dared each other to go inside. Being the brave one, I went first, followed by Jake, then Sarah and Emily. The inside was worse than the outside, broken furniture, torn wallpaper, and an overwhelming sense of decay. We split up to explore, a classic horror movie mistake, I know. I went upstairs, where the floorboards creaked under my feet. Every step echoed through the empty house. As I entered what must have been a bedroom, I saw something that made my blood run cold. On the wall, written in what looked like dried blood, were the words, "Leave now." I called out to the others, my voice shaking. They came rushing up, and when they saw the writing, everyone freaked out. Jake, trying to be rational, said it was probably some prank by other kids. But then we heard it, a low, guttural growl coming from downstairs. No one was brave anymore. We bolted for the stairs, but halfway down, Emily screamed. Something had grabbed her ankle. I turned and saw a shadowy figure, not fully formed, more like a dense, black mist with glowing red eyes. We managed to pull Emily free, and we all ran out of the house, not stopping until we were well into the woods. As we caught our breath, we realized Emily was bleeding. Her ankle had deep, claw-like gashes. We got back to town as fast as we could and took her to the hospital. She needed stitches but was otherwise okay. We decided never to talk about it again, but that wasn't the end. Over the next few weeks, we all had nightmares about that house and the shadowy figure. Emily's wounds got infected, and she was in and out of the hospital. The worst part was the scratches would reappear, no matter how well they were treated. One night, I woke up to see the same glowing red eyes at the foot of my bed. I was paralyzed with fear, unable to move or scream. It just stared at me, and I heard that same growl. It disappeared after what felt like hours but was probably only seconds. We moved away from the town shortly after that. I still have nightmares occasionally, and every so often, I'll wake up with small scratches on my legs or arms. I don't know what we disturbed in that house, but I know one thing, it wasn't just a story. If you ever hear about an old, abandoned house deep in the woods, don't go looking for it. Some doors should stay closed. So, I love paranormal stuff. I try to find haunted places and explore. Anyway, sometimes I get really bored, and I'll go for walks at midnight or just at night. One night I'm talking to some friend about the school near me. I looked up online if anything happened there because I was looking for somewhere possibly haunted to investigate. Years ago, there were murders on Halloween, some people died. I thought this would be a perfect place, and I got ready. When I got to the school, nothing was happening, so I started mocking, saying if there's any ghosts here, you must be chickens because you aren't even trying to scare me. I started walking in the middle of the field and noticed the school lights were flickering. I heard someone running away from me, so I looked and saw someone running at me full speed across the field. They ran behind a crate close to me, and I went over, but nobody was there, nobody could have run away. I was watching the cage the whole time. At that point I knew something wasn't happy with what I said, so I went home. A couple of weeks go by, and my friend is trying to convince me to go back, but with him. I eventually cave, and one night we go, and I start to record. In the recording, you can hear someone walking from afar. You can barely hear it, but it gets louder as they get closer. They get close enough to where me and my friend started to hear it, and I had to tell him to be quiet so I could listen. It's dead quiet, and we both hear someone step on gravel, but nobody was even near. We looked everywhere that could make the noise, but nothing. When we started to agree to head home, we heard another step, but it was really close and we both looked at each other and decided to go home. The footage I had was corrupted somehow, so I had no proof except my word. I plan on going back this weekend and trying to record. This happened about 13 years ago, when I was a sophomore in college, attending a liberal arts school in Suffolk County, New York. Within the first month or two of freshman year, I had found myself in a very tight-knit group of fellow theater geeks, six guys, myself included, and one girl. And they all loved horror movies and ghost stories. I had found my crew. Freshman year was tough, but we all held each other up and made the whole experience more enjoyable for one another. At the start of sophomore year, we decided that in October, as the Halloween season was ramping up, we would find a creepy wooded spot in a nearby town some night and scare the crap out of ourselves. We did some research and found that there was a particularly isolated area about 30 minutes away, infamous for paranormal sightings. Perfect. The seven of us split into two different cars and headed out into the night. Allow me to set the scene. You turn off a busy main road, flooded with strip malls and restaurants and whatnot, and you are almost immediately greeted by complete darkness. Again, this area was very heavily wooded. It was essentially a large web of winding roads surrounded by trees. Very few streetlights, and very few houses. Without a GPS or a good sense of direction, one could easily get lost in there. We all made sure to have fully charged phones and flashlights just in case, but the goal was to keep driving until we collectively decided to pull over and go exploring. So per the directions, we made a left off of the main road, driving for 30 minutes or so into this dark network, picking directions at random, just getting intentionally lost. Our cars made a turn, and, to our surprise, there was a huge log in front of us. We had reached a dead end of some kind, with nothing but trees beyond it. We all got out to see what exactly this was, stepped over the log, and noticed two narrow trails leading in different directions. This seemed like as good a time as any to grab our flashlights and do some amateur ghost hunting. We flipped a coin and set off on the trail to the right. The trail was so narrow that we had to walk single file to avoid getting whacked by branches. For whatever reason, I ended up in the back. I'm usually pretty rational and level-headed, but I have to say, the further we went in, the more I was overcome with an uneasy feeling. I kept hearing sounds deep in the woods, unable to shake the feeling we were being watched. But I seemed to be the only one who heard these things, so I shrugged it off as my imagination. And, in any case, the whole point of us being there was to get scared. Not to mention the fact that we were seven able-bodied college students. What would we come across that could take us down? We headed down this trail for about 20 minutes, and just when I thought it would never end, we came to a massive clearing. And I mean massive. It was a large, open field of unkempt grass. Comparable in scope to a golf course, but not nearly as well manicured. Trees surrounded the entire field, which was so large, we could not see the end of it from where we were standing. I was thrilled to get out of that narrow trail, but I don't think any of us were expecting to find an area so vast. One of us looked to the right and said, "Hey, check that out." We all turned, and there was an old, dilapidated house several hundred yards away. The house was completely dark, with no cars or signs of anyone actually living there. We walked over and shined our flashlights at it, and sure enough, the windows and doors were all boarded up. I managed to peer between the boards on one of the windows, and what I could see was an old white couch covered in plastic, but an otherwise empty room. Whoever used to live here was long gone. Because there was no way in, and because we all felt sufficiently creeped out by the house anyway, we decided to walk closer to the trail we had come in from, have a seat in the field, and figure out where to go next. We walked towards the narrow trail, but before we could sit, my friend Mark stopped what he was doing. His expression dropped, and he pointed. We all turned, and we could see someone tall, on a very far side of the field, directly across from where we had come in. We could see someone tall, lanky, and pale dancing among the trees. And by dancing, I mean skipping around, grabbing a tree, swinging around it, and then doing the same to another tree. Basically, it's a do-si-do. The moon was so bright and the woods so dark, it actually took a second for us to really understand what we were looking at. Jay, the 6'4" skeptic of the group, wasn't seeing it. I learned from him, pointed in that direction, and said, "Jay, look where I'm pointing. Don't you see that?" He squinted a bit, and the second that he saw it, he gasped with everything he had, clutched my arm, and whispered, "What the duck is that?" What happened next sent shockwaves through all of us. Whoever this was, they stopped dancing, looked in our direction, and started charging straight at us. Without even thinking, we freaked and ran back to the trail. Yet again, Jay was the only one who didn't see what was happening. He shouted after us, "Guys, what is it? Where are you going?" After about 15 seconds of running like hell, I heard Jay scream, "Holy shit." I looked back and saw his flashlight following the rest of us into the trail. While the walk into the woods took about 20 minutes, we made it back to our two cars, hopped in, and were peeling away in closer to 5. Once we were a safe distance away, we pulled over, got out, and checked in with each other about what just happened. My heart was pounding, and I know everyone else was feeling the same way. Nearly 15 years later, we are all still friends, living in different states yet keeping in touch through marriages, divorces, children, etc. But occasionally, out of the blue, one of us will send a group text to the others with something like, "The woods. That really happened, right?" It most certainly did. That experience is always in the back of my mind, and I'm pretty sure it always will be. Here's the thing that still resonates with me about that night. Whoever that was, they were dancing maniacally in the woods at 1 in the morning and then ran directly for a group of young adults, not at all fazed by the fact that they were severely outnumbered. Did he know we were there from the second we parked? Was he the sound that I kept hearing when we walked the trail? Whatever the case may be, when he came for us that night, you can be sure none of us wanted to stick around and see what he was truly capable of. It was my birthday. After a night of Jack Daniels and some devil's lettuce, we sobbed up a little and got bored. My buddy had a 90s GMC Jimmy. I offered him some gas money to hit a couple trails and dirt roads. Small town around midnight, so it was pretty typical to go kill some time just riding trails out on the Rees. We just call the Eglin Reservation the Rees down here, so anyways, we hit a main trailhead that leads to an area known as Timberlake Pond. Well, about a decade plus ago, the many side trails branching off of it were public access. Due to military testing and drills, they periodically close some areas, as well as simply managing the roads. Weather can take a pretty serious toll out there. I've been on roads that simply disappeared and washed out from a single heavy storm. Anyway, there was this one trail that me and my buddy really liked to hit. Back in the day, my pops would have us dump old tree branches and trimmings and yard junk out there. Nothing bad, just wood and leaves, never any type of plastic or garbage ever. The dumping spot was a good 30-minute drive in Pop's old Dodge off the Timberlake trailhead. You'd hit a very narrow, overgrown side trail that became a clearing after about 0.5 miles. Further down the road is nothing but a pure sand washout that goes downhill. Never chanced it because it was so rough looking. Fast forward to my birthday night. The GMC was light enough even with three passengers to just glide over the sand ruts without the need for 4x4. So we go and we go, and then we finally stop to give the truck a break and partake in some more devil's lettuce. The one guy is under the hood of the Jimmy, just giving it a quick one over. Me and my other buddy are about 10 yards away, just admiring the natural beauty of the moonlit trail deep in the FL jungle, that when things got odd. It was quite. Very quite. So I and my buddy, who are avid hunters and outdoorsmen, exchange puzzled glances. It's just too damn quiet. Then we hear it. Or one of them. A muffled distant scream. It's a feminine sounding one. Then came a yell, which was more masculine. When I tell you that we are miles and miles from people, it's not an exaggeration. We are about 15 miles deep in the woods of a military reservation. There are no people out there. Especially where we were. You gotta have inside knowledge to get this far. So me and buddy turn around and start backing up towards our other friend, who is still unaware. Then the screaming gets loud. Ear-piercing hair standing loud. Both masculine and feminine. Then the ducking brush starts to shake, and the trees are moving. Whatever was screaming was without a doubt beelining straight for us through a brush that would have been physically impossible for a human to simply walk through. Let alone how fast it was moving. At this point we are jumping in the Jimmy, and another buddy throws it in reverse. Didn't even try to turn around. Didn't try to wait. We simply left as fast as three stone teenagers possibly could. Came back a few days later, and the entire access was and is still to this day chained off and barred shut. If anyone else has managed to read this and has had something similar happen, please share. My partner and I were touring the community of townhouses that he will be moving into. This community has no gym but posts around the community, a trail that will take you from a monkey bar to something else, like a treasure hunt with exercise machines. It was 11:30 p.m., and there we were walking and exploring and reaching that last machine. This machine was fully afar from everything else, lots of trees, kind of foresty behind it. We see the trail sign, and we start walking to it. Behind the sign, there was this big box, which kind of looked like maybe something electrical inside. Anyway, as we reach the sign, my partner turns his flashlight on, and we try to read the sign. The flashlight kind of lights the box behind, and he sees something, so he yells, "Hey!" Immediately I look as well, and there is this tiny figure that looked like a person, maybe as high as my knees. My partner immediately starts running and grabs my arm, and I freak out and start running too. He wanted to keep exploring, and I just wanted to leave. I felt like throwing up. Lil dude kind of started standing up and was about to wave. I thought, but it was a couple seconds until I ran. His movements were very human. I am scared as hell. What did we see? I was honestly hoping it was a raccoon, but it would be kind of cool if it wasn't, I guess. Still very shaken, don't know how I'll sleep tonight, and my partner is also very confused. I live on the Kentucky-Tennessee border. My house is in Tennessee, and our backyard is half fenced off and half wooded and continues to a collapsed barbed wire fence that separates the states. I like to go exploring out there. During the summer everything is a shadow of green, and in the winter the blanket of snow is just really peaceful. Because there are crop fields nearby, I assume the land belongs to a farmer because there are crop fields not far off. After you pass the collapsed fence, I keep going another 10 or 20 yards until I hit a small clearing in the trees. I don't go too far out because I don't want to risk getting shot by some crazy redneck. As an added defense against possible hunters, I always go out in my bright red jacket. I like to go out and explore the terrain. There are many sinkholes and fallen trees to explore. Occasionally, I'll find bones and feathers that I use in my artwork. One winter I went out past the small clearing, something I'd never done before. I was in unfamiliar territory. Thinking back, I don't know why I went further, curiosity maybe. But after I left the clearing and went into the thick woods again, I immediately felt uneasy. But I had chalked it up to being in a new place and the higher risk of getting caught trespassing. I decided to put in an earbud to calm my nerves. I had a playlist specially made for wandering in the woods. After a few steps in, I noticed that the bright white snow was a light gray now. The trees, even with no leaves, were closer together than the ones near my house, so much so that they were making it darker than usual. And for some reason I determined turning my volume up would make me feel better. The exploration song from the Coraline movie was playing. Fitting, I know. When the song ended, there was a second of silence before the next song started.
In that second, I heard a distant scream.
Thinking I've been found by the owner of the property, I pulled my headphones out. I looked around to try and spot the source of the noise, but everything was quiet except for the slight buzz from the music coming out of the earbuds. I began to back up and turn to continue my exploration, and when I was completely around, I heard the scream again. But it wasn't distant this time, it was loud, it sounded like a mixture of man and beast hollering in pain. Right. Behind. My head. I wiped my body around and leapt back. But there was no ground. I fell into one of the deep gullies. I saw a dark blur as I fell, then I blacked out. When I awoke, I was being dragged across the snow. The back of my head felt warm and wet. Everything was moving in and out of focus. I moved my gaze toward my feet. Someone dressed in all black was pulling by my ankles. But something was off. It appeared to be wearing antlers, but they were unnaturally large. I let out a groan, and the black blur turned its head to me. It was wearing a deer skull for a mask. My head hurt too much to understand what this person was doing. All I knew was that someone was dragging me somewhere, and that I was hurt, I had to get away. That's when I started looking around and noticed something odd about this person's knees. They were bent back like an animal's, not like a human's. Things were becoming more focused now, and I could make out vertebrae sticking out of its back. This thing was skinny, with its hip bones protruding out and small tufts of hair. I could tell it was tall. Taller than 6 feet. 7 feet. Maybe even taller. When I regained all my senses, I only needed a second to make the connection. I had listened to plenty of scary stories to know what this creature was. Now I'm not a screamer, anything that makes normal people scream makes me laugh, for I'm just quiet. But I screamed. I screamed like a mother ducking banshee on crack. Which I think surprised the beast, because he dropped my leg and retreated, screaming itself. I never ran so fast in my life. The cold air was burning in my lungs. I was looking at the sky, the sun was setting. I changed my course, knowing if I ran south I'd eventually hit a road or house something away from these woods. I could hear it scream once more, it made me run faster. When I got out of the woods, I ended up in a soccer field behind an elementary school down the road from my house. I collapsed on the ground, trying to catch my breath. My heart stopped when I heard my phone ringing in my pocket. It was my mom calling to make sure I was okay. The dogs were barking like crazy because they heard the faint scream from the woods. My mom thought it might have been a wild cat. I broke down crying, telling her to please come get me. She tried to comfort me by saying it was just some crazy redneck serial killer. But part of her knew what I saw wasn't a nutjob asshole in the woods. I ended up getting 6 stitches in the back of my head from the fall. It's been 2 years since I've gone back to the woods, and we're finally moving. I have been mulling over this experience for 11 years. I was around 21 years old at the time. My best friend, whom I consider to be my brother, was 20. There was a place that we often spent time at. It was a place called Clear Creek. While there were good memories, such as our campfires and our wandering through the woods, there were aspects of that particular place that left me haunted with its peculiarity and its strange ties to the unknown. I will begin in the best of an order of events that can be salvaged. Clear Creek Preserve was an interesting place that was home to untamed prairies, thick forests, and the unknown beasts that live within. A part of the forest appeared to have suffered from a forest fire and never healed from this experience, leaving it desolate and void of life. This particular area of the preserve was towards a lesser-known entrance. In this particular area, my brother and I found stick figures strung up in trees, similar to the Blair Witch totems. Following this experience, we found a group of young college students filming in the preserve. What caught me off guard was their clothing. It appeared that they were dressed in a sense close to those belonging in a coven. These two experiences were standalone, and not much came from that. There was another incident relating to another aspect of Clear Creek Preserve. There is a group of people who live in the forest. They appear to live in shanty houses and ride along in ATVs. This alone would not bother me, were it for the fact that there is a junk school bus, riddled with bullet holes. My brother is in the military currently. He has an affinity for all things relating to gunpowder. Upon further inspection of the school bus and finding the lodged round and the casing, he quickly determined one thing: these people were firing full metal jackets. Upon finding this dark discovery, they went on patrol. In a blazingly quick decision, we hid in the tall grasses and waited for them to finish before we ran off that day. I'd like to say that this was the worst of it. The horizon, I am afraid, gets much darker. Near the shanty enclave, there was what appeared to be a destroyed house. Debris littered everywhere, and in the midst of the destruction was a single small fridge with a putrescent stench. My brother and I came across this fridge and found it bound tight with a harness. Our naivete would prove to be our foolish reckoning, as I am still haunted by what I saw that day. My brother's morbid curiosity got the best of him, and he decided that it would be intelligent to open this fridge. The harness would not budge. I warned him over and over, "Please do not open the fridge." He continued doing so to reckless avail. I damn my situational awareness. For I saw straddled about the fridge in an almost memorial sort of manner, the building blocks for a child, a child's Bible, and the shoes of an infant. By the time I warned him and ran to stop him, he managed to get it open, and what I saw haunts me to this day. The fridge door flung open, and the rancid stench of decay overwhelmed us both. I felt the blood drain from my face as I saw in a bundle of grocery bags the small, decayed hand of an infant. My brother asked what I saw, and he heard the sounds of the ATV showing up just in time. We ran off again, and I distinctly remember hearing the call of the crows. Or perhaps they were the horrified exclamations of the people who put that child there. We pondered the idea of calling the police that day, but we returned only to find the bundled bag missing from the fridge. It almost felt as if we unleashed something that day. The final time that we went to that area of Clear Creek was when we decided that we would go there to camp for the night. It was almost as if whoever was there knew that we were coming. We'd hiked that day to Clear Creek. It was a particularly hot July day. We were more than pleased to be under the trees in that place. By the time we had arrived, we were hot and tired. We approached the entrance of Clear Creek, and we were almost immediately bombarded with the call of the crows. It almost seemed as though they were saying, "Go back." Everything went silent, and thinking about it in this moment brings fearful tears up as I can vividly recall the deep demoniac groaning from within the forest. A hollowed, unhuman echo that seemed to draw me in. My brother heard it too, and he screamed at me that we must leave. The echoing got louder, sending deathly shivers through my skin as the hairs on my body stood up. The groaning stopped, and we were panicking as whatever seemed to make that noise began to dart around us as if it were hunting us. We ran because whatever that thing was, we were not equipped to handle it. We called our friend and asked her to pick us up. She did, and we sat in silence until we were free of that place. Despite the darkness of that place, there was beauty in it. We'd often go back and cook, explore the forests, and even fall into the river. The haunts and the love of that time bring a beautiful yet biting nostalgia. If you approach the Clear Creek Preserve, appreciate the beauty of nature, do not go off the trails, and if you hear the calling of the crows, run. Recently, I was curious about finding a ghost, since I've been herbexing for a while. This couple reached out to me and shared videos of themselves leaving this place with gashes from encountering a ghost inside this abandoned church. It would throw things at people and appear in plenty of photos as well. So naturally I was intrigued. Keep in mind I don't believe in ghosts, it was just a facet of my hobby I was curious on seeing. When it came to going, it was the most dangerous town in the city. So there was already an air of dread in the town. Walking in, I was immediately hit with the smell of death. I can't describe it any other way. The couple started to explain that all the history of the place has been scrubbed off the internet, but apparently it was a place where plenty of people were unalived after it was shut down, according to them. They described Al Capone coming in here to unalive people, and their proof was what the Ouija board told them. Then I started to hear faint humming. I assumed it was a car outside, but it seemed so disembodied, as if it were in my head but also across the church. It was very strange. As we got closer to where it came from, they noticed it. "Do you hear the humming?" And I heard it loud and clear. It was just a little girl humming very quietly, but you could tell it was a harmony of some sort. I didn't say anything. I recorded it, but the recording didn't show it because it wasn't a physical humming. They also started to talk about the spirit and said that they visit this church almost every day and have played the Ouija board in it to speak to the spirit. They told me the spirit was a little girl that was hung here before they even built the place as a witch. I felt a bit skeptical about this now, since they told me there were Al Capone type unalived people in there, and that one day some other people were chased out by a priest, and the day after that they, the couple, found the priest's robe covered in blood on the altar. You might be lying to scare me, probably. There's no other proof of this than their own anecdotal evidence. The smell was so unbearable, it was just waves of the smell of death. And I felt these strange sensations of dread that I have never in my life felt before. It was like the air was pushing against me as if it were wind, but it wasn't. Never felt that before. It was this feeling of I am not supposed to be in here that Urbexers will usually get, but this was on 1000X. We passed by the same area afterwards after I asked them to get out with me. We passed by the same area. The little girl was harmonizing louder. They could hear it too because they pointed it out after the fact, but at that point I wanted to just get the hell out. Walking out of the church, they wanted to enter a building right next door, which they told me was even more haunted, and that a red brick was thrown at a friend of theirs where I was standing previously from the roof. The building had no red bricks. I've seen enough proof for my entire lifetime though, I just wanted to leave, and we did. They showed me photos of ghosts they captured on their phone. Looked very strange. One of them looked very circular and strange, looking like a halo almost. Another was just a shadowy figure. They've brought some friends there before, and they told me their friends heard a girl talking but couldn't make out what she was saying, as well as the humming being way more pronounced and louder, and this time it was very faint. Churches I always avoid when Urbexing. They have this energy of darkness that hangs over them that makes me feel like a lot of mourning, sadness, and anger was taken out inside from the people that would go to the church. My theory is that energy doesn't disappear when you let it out, it lingers, and if there was some energy that was strong enough to linger and stay trapped in there, it may not even be ghosts in a conventional sense, per se, but the torment manifested by many mourning humans. I felt like the voice might have come from the girl in the couple, since she told me that the spirit was attached to her since she played the Ouija board and it said that to her. She also spoke with other spirits that spelled out run and henchmen. I still feel skeptical and was thinking audio was playing from her phone, but I checked their phones as the humming sound was happening. To be clear, it wasn't kind of the sound of a girl humming, it definitely was. But everything in my mind was telling me that this wasn't a little girl. The couple was also weirdly not fazed at all. They told me they went there nearly every day and just hung out there. They see the ghost as just something that's there. I felt like they've led people inside a few times before as well. I also took plenty of footage and photos the entire time, and I caught a photo of the couple, and the girl that claimed the spirit was attached to had her eyes glowing bright white in one photo. That wasn't normal, my friends pointed this out. Definitely not going to explore with these people ever again. Thinking about it now, I'm sure that if I went by myself, none of these feelings or sounds would have manifested. I have a feeling that the couple was the source of all of it, since they are looking to conjure it with the Ouija act. This was a handful of years ago. I was a new mother and home with my firstborn child. He was a couple weeks old, and it came time for me to get an oil change and tire rotation for my car. Instead of sitting in the dealership waiting room for an hour plus, I figured this would be a good opportunity to walk around this arboretum that wasn't too far away. I've been to the arboretum a handful of times before, but this time I noticed a sign for Patriot's Path. This is a paved trail that extends 35 miles throughout the county. The trails are broken down into segments as they are separated by roadways or neighborhoods. I would frequent other parts of the path and never feel uncomfortable. In fact, it was a nice way to feel connected to nature while sometimes encountering other people exercising and doing the same. Without hesitation, I decided to walk the path to kill time. I was excited to explore this new-to-me trail. First, the path cut through tall grasses, then it curved and increasingly became more of a wooded area. This wasn't concerning to me, as all the other parts of the trail that I have walked on were exclusively in the woods. As I was pushing my newborn in a stroller and enjoying my time in nature, I came to a fork in the path. The other parts of the trail I've been on were always one path, no forks. The right path was on higher ground, so I headed that way. As I was going, the path became increasingly difficult for the stroller. Tree roots broke through the path, and it was a rough ride for my baby. I wasn't able to keep the pace I was going. Since I was going significantly slower, I looked on my map app to see if it included the path and where it would bring us. On the map, the left side of the fork traveled along a waterway. So I decided to try that route. As I was turning around, I saw a man well-dressed, slowly strolling towards us. I got the stroller free from the tree roots and started towards him. He had his phone up to his face as if he were on a phone call, but he wasn't talking. We got closer, and I looked at him to give a friendly nod, as I usually do when passing people on the path. He just looked straight ahead, expressionless. When I was processing that interaction, my gut told me something was off. He was wearing an outfit I could best describe as business casual. Most people on the trails are in exercise clothes. He wasn't talking at all on his phone that he held up to his ear in the other hand. He was concealing it. He had it in a rigid position behind his back, as if he were carrying something that he didn't want me to see. I turned to walk the opposite path of the fork and convinced myself I was imagining it all. After some more walking, I heard the sound of babbling water. According to my map app, I thought I should be able to see the waterway by now, and the path should open up to a parking lot. I felt like I should see the parking lot by now. When I tried opening my map again, my phone wasn't working. I was in the woods, alone with my baby, with no phone access, and I had a strange interaction. It was time to turn around and head out of the woods. Much to my dismay, there was that man again. His face was still expressionless. His phone was still up to his ear. He was still not talking on the phone. And his other hand, still hiding behind his back. I felt my heart sink into my stomach and my stomach jump into my throat. Why did he turn around on the first part of the path? Why did he turn toward the fork? He was close enough to us for me to realize he must have turned around soon after we did. He must have seen us turn down the opposite path at the fork. All the alarms in my body were ringing, get out of here. When it was time to pass him, I began to jog. Hey, I'm wearing the appropriate outfit for a trail that most people use for exercise. Maybe my intention was to jog this whole time? I didn't stop jogging until I was out of the woods and in the tall grass. I turned to look behind me, and luckily my son and I were alone again. I jogged some more until there was a large distance between us and the trail. We waited in the dealership waiting room for the rest of the time they were working on my car. I did go back to the Arboretum after that, but I haven't ventured down that section of the trail ever again. Now maybe that was just a regular businessman. Nothing happened between me and this man, and maybe nothing was going to happen. But personally, I'd rather go for an unplanned jog, than ignore my gut and find out. Not really abandoned, but was driving way out on some logging roads in Nee, Washington, somewhere near Colville about 25 plus years ago when I came across a small religious cult dressed in robes in the middle of performing some ritual way out in the woods. Then somewhere in the same general vicinity we came across some sort of landfill junkyard neighborhood of overturned buses and other piles of absolute filth that was being used as a sort of backwoods village. There were multiple households to whatever extent and absolutely reeked of human shit and piss. As we drove through, some creepy-ass obese man in a diaper was just standing and staring at us like a zombie while his emaciated dog barked as we navigated through the grossest situation I've ever witnessed. It was part of a job I was hired to prove that certain land parcels existed, so I had no choice but to keep going, but it was the weirdest ducking drive I've ever had. Also, almost got stuck in the mud deep up the road right next to some sketchy shack house someone obviously lived in, and we were sweating bullets trying to get our truck turned around and not have to ask for help. It was Halloween around 15 years ago. There was a group of us that loved to go to haunted or scary places on Halloween before we would go out for a night of bar crawling. So this particular Halloween we went to an abandoned house where no tenant would stay longer than 1 month. It was creepy, but nothing stuck out to me as a haunted place. Then we went to a house where a family was unlived, supposedly by an escaped mental patient. That place was not scary at all, just sad. So then I told my friends about Jacob Skinner's grave in the mountains and how if you ask a question at his grave, he answers by knocking once for yes or twice for no. So all seven of us squeezed back in my 1999 Ford Explorer and went up to the mountains. It took a bit to get there, and we were all laughing and having a good time. Little did we know what was about to happen to us that would change the way we thought forever. So when we arrive up there, we pull into a pretty big turnout across the street from where his grave is. It was night, so when we pulled up, the lights were on, and the turnout was empty, just a big dirt patch. So we all crossed the street and started up the hill towards the grave. The path to his grave is pretty steep, with bushes and trees all around. We barely started walking up the path when I noticed the lights on my car came on. The side lights were on like someone was trying to get in, and the interior lights on the inside of the car were on as well. I started pressing my alarm button, and the car was locked. It was weird, but nothing stopped us from going up to the grave. So Jacob Skinner was a miner from the 1800s in the mountains on the West Coast when he passed away at the age of around 50 years old. His body was transported a few years after his death back to the East Coast, but they left the gravestone there. We get to his grave and start asking questions with no responses. But then one of us, we will call her Alice, swore she heard two knocks, meaning no, when she asked if her mother would survive breast cancer, which she did not, unfortunately. This upset her, but then she thought maybe we were just messing with her. We didn't want her to be more upset, so we didn't deny doing it, even though none of us knocked or did anything at all. We stayed at the grave for around 20 minutes and started to walk back down to the car. About halfway down the path, I could see the same lights now blinking on my car. These lights don't blink, and their behavior seemed inexplicable. We all started to get freaked out by this time and hurried back to the car as fast as possible. When we got back there, the lights on the car switched off as soon as I touched it. All the doors were locked, and I couldn't even get the lights to switch on when I used the door handle, like they should, or when using the alarm remote. Then all of a sudden I hear what in the actual FCK coming from my friend Alan. I walked to the front of the Explorer, and there was a huge 12-foot pentagram in the dirt that wasn't there when we got there. There were five large candles lit around the pentagram, all black. We were so amazed by the size we didn't even think about who the hell did this while we were all at the grave. No cars drove by, and no vehicles were around us for miles. Even though it was Halloween, it was a warmer night, but when we got back down to the car, the air got thicker and the temperature dropped like 15 degrees. When we stopped being mesmerized by this huge pentagram with candles, we started to look around to see who was messing with us. We couldn't find anyone, but we weren't walking deep into the forest either. We did hear these crazy, weird noises, though. There were all these branches cracking around us, a very loud slash deep howling, and laughing. Yes, laughing, but we couldn't see anyone. It was one of the most terrifying moments of my life. By this time, we decided that it was time to get the hell out of there. We all packed back into the Explorer. Scott and Alice were sitting in the way back where there are no seats. It's like the trunk of the Explorer. We got out of there very quickly. We were even afraid of being followed. We got to the bottom of the mountain in about 20 minutes, and we thought it was all over. Boy, were we wrong. Scott starts screaming to stop the car over and over. When I asked what was going on, he said Alice was freaking out. Freaking out, I replied. Scott was starting to try to jump into the back seat, which was full and impossible, especially since he was a big boy. I pulled over before he got us in an accident. We all get out except Alice, who was in this like trance state, repeating the same thing over and over, which was gibberish. She was also using her finger and making pentagrams on the back window. We could not get her to snap out of it for at least 5 minutes, which seemed like an eternity. It was so bad another friend there was on the phone with 911, but they thought we were joking. There was a hospital about 10 minutes away, so we all figured we would take her there. The only problem was there were 7 of us, and no one wanted to sit back there with her except me, but I was the sober driver, and they had a few before we left. As we are arguing on who was going to sit back there, Alice swung her head back, screamed, and we could only see the whites of her eyes. It was the scariest thing I have ever witnessed, a true exorcism moment. But then, just like that, it was over. She jumped out of the car and asked what bar we were going to first. She didn't remember anything. She didn't even remember going to the gravesite. To this day we talk about it, and she is in disbelief she acted that way because she only had 3 drinks the whole night and nothing for well over an hour. Usually she is so bubbly and happy. I don't know what happened up there that Halloween. I don't know if she was possessed. I don't know who made the pentagram or lit the candles. All I know is we definitely got our fill of fear that night. We never did a haunted place crawl again and never will. The mountains are a mysterious and dangerous place. So if you are there at night, pay attention, listen, know your surroundings, and for God's sake, if you don't feel safe, don't stay. So this story is from when I was about 12 years old. I am 18 now. The setting of this story is around January and in rural Minnesota. If anyone's ever been around here, you'd know there isn't anything around besides trees, farmland, and snow in upper Minnesota. One day, about an hour before sunset, my brother and I were playing outside in the snow as usual, and I decided I wanted to go explore the woods and make a fort. My brother was a very paranoid little kid, so he wouldn't come with me. As I'm trekking through our little snow-covered alfalfa field towards the woods right in front of me, there are tiny bear footprints, human footprints. I look back to see where they came from, the road. Before anyone says deer tracks look similar to human feet, remember that I live in rural Minnesota. I've seen deer tracks almost 100 times before that. Also, these steps looked bipedal, walking on two legs. We have no neighbors for at least a 3/4 of a mile as well. As I'm looking at these tracks, I see that they lead to the woods. I remember getting a terrible feeling, but my little dumbass decided to follow them anyway. No joke, I follow those footprints for about a 1/4 mile into the woods. I started feeling sick as I saw the footprints cross a barbed wire fence without a sign of struggle and straight into a big brush pile of what I assume someone dumped there at some point. Was something leading me here? I didn't want to know. I look at the brush pile one more time to see that the child's footprints never left the brush. I ran all the way home as I felt I was being watched. Thinking back on it, I wish I explored that brush pile, but at the same time, who knows what I would have found. This took place in the fall of 2016, when I was 15 years old. My friend had told me about this abandoned state school for the feeble-minded in Belchertown, Massachusetts. He said he'd gone before, and it was super cool inside. It had a huge auditorium and many halls with graffiti sprayed everywhere. We all thought it'd be a fun idea to visit together. You're not supposed to go in, we were trespassing, and it was full of asbestos, we didn't care, stupid 15-year-olds. For context, there were 4 of us in total, 2 were my friends and 1 was a friend's girlfriend. We all got into one of my friend's cars and took the hour and a half drive to get there. When we got there, we entered the building, and I was immediately uneasy. It was so creepy. Everything was decrepit. There was graffiti all over the walls, upside down crosses, etc. I decided to take some pictures to see if maybe I'd pick up some orbs. Even though I didn't know this place was haunted, I figured with its history it could be. So I started taking photos, and one of them had a huge orb flying around. It could have been dust or asbestos particles, but it stood out in the photo. After we explored for a while, we decided to head to a different section of the state school. We left and started walking outside again. Eventually, we came to this section that sloped downhill and had a big smokestack on top of the roof area. This night was a full moon, and I was the last one walking in our line. I decided to turn around as the moon was just above the slope we'd come down. When I looked back, I swore I'd seen the silhouette of a person, at the top of the slope, standing in front of the moonlit background, but when I looked again, there was nothing there. Now this could have been my mind playing tricks on me, but what comes next was definitely real. Me and my friends decided to stand around and be as quiet as possible to see if we could hear anything outside. Being fall, there were piles of leaves all over the ground. We stood in silence for maybe 10 seconds when all of a sudden, no more than 5 feet away from us, where we could visibly see there was nobody there, big, heavy footsteps started dragging through the piles of leaves, very slowly and deliberately coming towards us before stopping. We all looked at each other, and my friend Dan said, "Did you guys hear that?" We were all in shock. We all started giggling like shits and started running back to the car as fast as we could. In terror and excitement. Does anyone else have any experiences at Belchertown or any other supposedly haunted locations? Terrifying urbex encounter. Everything started with me and a couple of my buddies hanging out at my place. Michael and Lucas. Basically, everyone got pretty much wasted from drinking too much cheap whiskey Michael has brought with him. It was around 2 a.m. when Lucas, still a bit drunk, suggested we should go and explore the abandoned insane asylum. For context, we all live together in the same small town. There is not much going on there, but when you drive about 15 miles on empty backroads, you should come across the old mental hospital, which has been vegetating ever since it was abandoned in the 1960s due to unknown reasons. Back to the story, so since there was really nothing better to do, we all agreed to the 30-minute drive. We grabbed our backpacks, some water, 3 flashlights, and a big hunting knife for protection. Lucas also brought a couple of graffiti cans for obvious reasons. Yeah, he was into that stuff at the time. The drive was relatively unspectacular, with the exception that Michael almost ran over a rattlesnake laying in the middle of the road. When we arrived, the sight of this huge asylum just standing there for all these years made me feel a little uneasy. But my doubts quickly evaporated as Michael and Lucas were already going around the place looking for an entrance. We finally found a window that was not completely boarded up with beams, and then crawled head first through the small opening. I quickly got on my feet and let my eyes adjust to the darkness that completely surrounded us. We powered up our flashlights and began wandering through the corridors with rooms on either side. The walls were pretty much all covered in graffiti. So Lucas suggested that we should look out for a basement entrance with the intention of finding a free spot for his graffiti. After a 30-minute search, we finally found the basement entrance. The stairs were rusty and creaked with every step. The whole basement smelled terrible. Lucas quickly disappeared down a long hallway with rooms on either side, with Michael and I keeping pace up behind him. As we wandered off further into the dark hallway, where our cheap flashlights only poorly lit up, the terrible smell even grew worse. I can only describe it as a mixture of vomit and rotten eggs. What struck me as odd was that all the walls were pretty much clean, unlike the site we made at the first floor. It almost seems like nobody has ever made it all the way to explore the basement level. Everything was going relatively smooth up until the point when Lucas started making much noise by shaking his graffiti cans in order to prepare them for his act of vandalism. So he started spray painting one of the nearby walls. Michael and I just watched him do his thing. When he finally finished his piece, the smell of aerosol in the air almost drowned out the horrible stink that was still in the air. As we made our way down the hallway, I could tell that the smell came from a small room further down to the left of us. At this point, we were all pretty much freaking out about what we would find in that room. I had the hunting knife tight in my hands as I approached the room and shined my flashlight aside. The light beam hit, and, I kid you not, a circle of burned out candles. In the center of the candles was a dark object hanging from the ceiling. At this point I had to vomit because of the smell coming from this room. Michael was the bravest one of us as he stumbled into this room grabbing a metal bar from the pile of junk next to him, poking the object with it, as right then we realized the huda amount of dark brownish stains on the floor under that thing. We all quickly sobbed up due to the situation, as we heard several voices and fast approaching footsteps from across the other hallway. I never ran that fast in my entire life. It's really amazing what adrenaline can affect. We finally reached the set of stairs and sprinted through the floor. As we finally reached the window we had entered from, Michael also vomited onto the floor. Lucas then realized that he had left his backpack full of his stuff in the basement, as he had not had enough time to pick it up. We sprinted out front and got into my car and hightailed it out of there. As far as I know, we only have suggestions of what we saw in that basement. Maybe there was some kind of satanic ritual taking place there. Or we just stumbled across a murder scene. We haven't told anybody this story. In fact, Lucas told me that he had not had a good night of sleep since that day, knowing he left his wallet and his backpack there, keeping all his personal information, including his home address. Several years ago, I was home on leave with a girl I was seeing at the time, 2010. Visiting my parents in the burbs of Chicago only has so much entertainment, and we had burned ourselves out on Chicago. After dinner one of our last nights in town, we both were looking to do something exciting to really end our time there with a bang. Before I had left for the military, I was a bit of a thrill seeker that more or less fell into the hobby of urban exploring. My friends and I would wait for nightfall, grab our moonbeams, and drive out to whatever rural almost town we'd heard rumors about. Great fun for the weekends when we couldn't find anyone irresponsible enough to buy us a case of high life. I convinced my girlfriend to take the drive with me, and off we went. During my illustrious career as a pro trespasser, the one place I always wanted to go but could never make it to was the fabled Manteno State Asylum. Total classic, a turn-of-the-century tuberculin ward repurposed into a state-run mental hospital back when they were poignantly depraved and evil. Please don't take my flippant words as disrespect, I mean that within the confines of this one slightly illegal hobby. It was truly hellish for those patients, and the history is disgusting. Anyway, around 11 p.m. I started driving south toward the town. It took me about an hour and a half from where my parents lived, and at some point during the trip it started pissing down rain. My wipers couldn't keep up, so I slowed way the hell down as I made my approach to the main drag, trying to get a good look at everything. Typical small town stuff, 7 or 8 tiny storefronts crammed together in front of a row of parking stalls. A diner, a pharmacy, a quaint little clothing shop, you get the picture. All of them sat dark and empty as they should, but I couldn't figure out why it still felt so odd. Finally, I realized none of the streetlights were on, even though they were plentiful. There were maybe 3 of 15 lit up. As we crawled past the dead shops, I could barely make out the rest of the town through the fat drops of rain. It seemed to be 2 main streets surrounded by squat 1950s era ranch homes. Small plots, no fences, roads felt barely paved. Again, there were streetlights, but few of them seemed to work, and the area was mostly illuminated by bright yellow industrial lights attached to buildings. The road ended at a median, and I could just barely make out what I had been looking for this whole time, the old administration building for the hospital. It had been repurposed into a bank or something similar, but it was important as it was my only familiar landmark that I had memorized the map around. It was at this point, however, that I realized we were being watched. To my left, a man had come out of the door on the front of what I can only describe as a Quonset hut. There were four in a row directly behind the main street, and he appeared out of the first closest to us. The man stood silhouetted by an industrial lamplight and watched me drive past before turning on his heel and making his way back inside. He didn't seem to care about the soaking rain. I chalked it up to coincidence and moved on, looking for my next landmark. A few blocks over, and I found what I believe to be the old cemetery, reed, mass grave, and hollowed-out crematorium. While engaged in a bit of a somber conversation about the heaviness of it all, over my girlfriend's shoulder I see yet another man appear from inside one of the innocuous houses, amble to the edge of the property toward the street, and stare at my car. I guess I can't be sure of it because it was so dark, but he was definitely facing our direction, and the bright patch made while opening the door was obvious. Now unnerved, I turned off the music, dropped my car into drive, and pulled away to continue down the road we were on. He watched me drive away, and just as the last, when I got far enough out that he was small in my mirror, he pulled an about-face and returned to the house. I was starting to sweat a bit. We made a large loop around the original buildings that remained. Most had been demolished for safety reasons, but the remnants ranged from stoic and beautiful as it ever was to piles of brick jutting from the overgrowth like crooked teeth. Thick pillars and an imposing marbled cupola cast dramatic theatrical shadows in the lightning. The tiny hairs on the back of my neck began to perk up one by one as the paranoid feeling of being watched became all-consuming. Finally, mercifully, the edge of the town was in sight. We had seen it all, and my pride was satisfied enough to allow me the cowardice of fleeing this horrible town and never returning. The path we drove on abruptly dead-ended in a sloping left turn toward a corrugated metal pole barn. Needing to turn around, I followed it down into the small gravel parking lot. It was unoccupied, save a large blue dually backed into the far corner. Par for the course, a single piercing industrial light was fixed to the outside wall of the structure, bathing everything in harsh, sterile yellow. No exaggeration, the very second my tires touched that gravel, the door to the barn was yanked open and out strode a man. He took several steps into the parking lot, stopped, and stared. Just like the other two had. My butthole could crush diamonds at this point, and I'm doing my best Vin Diesel impression to fast and furious my way out of there, but just as I shift into reverse, I see another man open the door of the truck and begin to climb out, almost turning my Vin Diesel feel into more of a Paul Walker affair if you catch my meaning. There's not much more to add, I don't have any answers as I never went back and never investigated. We shot out of there and drove home mostly in uncomfortable silence. The rain let up at the county line. Avid hiker for many years and once, was exploring the desert area in a wash with alcoves alone. In a deeper one, I found many rings and rings of old car keys, the old metal kind without a fob. There were burned, white sheets with small bones. I notified the police, it was really hot out and they didn't want to go back and look, but I showed photos on my phone. They said they'd call if they needed me. I never got a call. Fast forward to maybe 5 years later. I drive by the other side of that mountain area, and they were literally excavating the bones of a dismembered body, found in a small pond at a golf course. I'm sure it was related. This story I'm about to tell only a few people close to me have ever heard. However, I never actually explained in detail what happened that night to absolutely anyone. For this story specifically, it is necessary to explain the general area I live in as it pertains to this event. I live next to Yellowstone National Park, which in and of itself has drawn millions of tourists each year. Part of the reason I am writing this is merely a warning to people who decide to visit during the summer months. Last year in the summer of 2020, me and some of my buddies decided to go have a night out and do some camping out near a spot we have been to multiple times in the past. After all, this was right after things started to become normal again and lockdowns were lifted. I decided to head up to the camp spot early in an effort to make sure my gear was still set up from earlier that day. I did this as an effort to reserve the spot as it's first come, first served. Therefore, with everything in hand, I left my house right before sunset. We were all supposed to meet up within the hour, so I didn't really have any concerns about being by myself. I then began my 30-minute drive up to the location. When I finally arrived, I immediately noticed my tent and everything inside was gone. Now, just for some context, I staked the tent down in multiple areas just to be sure it stayed for the period I was gone. Inside was my sleeping bag and a few other miscellaneous items I left just to keep it weighted down. However, everything, literally everything, disappeared as if it were never there. I looked around, and even the stakes and rocks I placed on the outside were missing. I immediately knew something was wrong because I did not see any campers on the way up. Also, keep in mind I do not have cell service as it's a couple miles back into the wilderness. I then decided to drive back down from where I came to get service and get a hold of my friends and let them know what happened. Least to say, I was not happy with the situation and knew that whoever took my belongings were still in the area as it had only been there for an hour or two. However, my friends insisted that I stay and at least hang out for a few hours, as it took weeks of planning. So once I made sure everyone arrived, I then decided to go around the area in search of any sign of footprints or indications that maybe these people were close by. As you can guess, I wasn't able to find anything. I eventually played it off and decided I would just look for it in the morning and contact the Forest Service to report it missing. I also didn't want to ruin the party for everyone and decided to stay. In hindsight, this was by far one of the worst decisions I could have ever made. As the night went on, everything seemed fine. So I thought. Around 1 or 2 in the morning, most of my friends decided to call it a night. I ended up sleeping in my truck. This was perhaps one of the better decisions that I made this night. That, along with always making sure to bring my bear spray and sidearm for protection from unexpected guests. I eventually fell asleep. However, it's important to note that I was still a bit on edge as only a couple hours before all of my belongings were taken. I decided to leave my window rolled down a bit just in case I heard anything creep up on us in the middle of the night. After about 2 hours of me being asleep, my worst nightmare came true. At first, I just heard something moving around outside of our camp. This was enough noise to wake me up, and I immediately froze and didn't move whatsoever. Therefore, this was partially because I knew whatever was making the noise was large. Not just a raccoon or any smaller creature. I then was paralyzed just listening intently to whatever was happening outside of our camp. My first thought was that it was a bear. We also had sightings recently in the area. At one point, I swear it could have only been maybe 20 to 30 yards away. Also, another key point I noticed was that there were absolutely no other sounds. Usually there's grasshoppers or birds, but it was complete and utter silence. Now in the wilderness, that's never a good sign. It means there's a large predator or something of the like in the area. Meanwhile, it's pitch black outside, and our fire has completely gone out. After about 15 minutes of not hearing anything, I decided I just needed to stop being paranoid. But just as I was about to fall back asleep, I saw something to the right of our campsite. It was just a few yards away from our fire pit and probably about 20 yards from me. To my absolute horror, it was a person. I immediately freaked. This was no average person either. Let alone the fact that it's 3 or 4 in the morning and you're at someone's campsite, this person was wearing what I made out to be some kind of mask. I got a very good look at whoever it was, and it was a deer skull on their face. They were wearing a black robe, and that's about all I noticed. I sure didn't want to leave my truck and confront this person, so I did what I thought was best. I turned my truck on and began honking the horn until all of my friends were awake. I rolled down the window and told them we needed to get out of here immediately. After seeing what I saw, I did exactly that. Meanwhile, this person hasn't moved, mind you. Just as I thought it was bad, the situation got even worse. More of these figures began appearing in front of us through the trees. Wearing the same outfits as mentioned earlier but with a multiple of different masks. I immediately put my truck into reverse and began speeding away. They began walking closer and closer, but luckily I was able to drive out of the spot in time. As I began to speed down the road out of there, three more of these figures appeared out from the side of my truck. This time with a dog and way more aggressive than the previous ones I saw. They began throwing rocks at my truck and chasing after me. At one point they were literally right next to my passenger window until I accelerated even more and eventually lost them. As I looked back in my mirror, I saw only one figure left. Just simply peeking and staring at me behind a tree. This image is forever seared into my head. From this night on, I refused to ever go back up there. I've never, ever spoken of this to anyone. Even when I was around my friends who experienced this, we never mentioned it to each other. It's been over a year now since this happened, and well, all I can say is that I believe these people were in some sort of cult. I heard other stories about similar events happening and even cattle completely disappearing. It's very barbaric, and you wouldn't think that such a beautiful national park that attracts so many people year-round would have such dark and disturbing secrets. My advice to anyone that decides to travel to these mysterious and preserved parks of intrinsic beauty would be to always bring protection of some kind. Likewise, make sure you let others know about your plans and never go alone. There are hundreds of missing persons reports across the national parks inside the United States, and I could have very well been one of them if I had stayed just a few minutes longer. Nature has a way to attract very different types of people. Some want to explore and push themselves to their limits, meanwhile, some simply don't want to be seen and lurk in the darkness of night. A former Green Beret once told me the key to survival was always being aware of your surroundings and listening to your instincts. If a particular situation doesn't feel right, chances are it's not. Stay safe, everyone. My parents owned a house across the street from a campground. The campgrounds were relatively small, but there was a huge forest attached. Beside the campground was a narrow, fast-moving river. Our best friends Katie and Debbie were around the same age as my sister and me. Every time we had a sleepover or a playdate, we would wander across the street, up a berm over the metal barrier into the campground, to explore the forest. Our adventures always involved spy games, hide and seek, and another, Katie and Debbie called the Black Witch. Katie and Debbie's mom would tell us stories of the Black Witch lurking in the shadows of the pine trees, kidnapping young girls to eat and cursing the ones that got away. So as kids, we decided let's find this witch, of course only thinking it was a tall tale, fabricated for our horror, so we wouldn't wander off the path in the forest. One day we set out on our adventure through the forest at dusk to find the Black Witch. So up the berm and over the metal barrier we went. The golden hour, as they called it, had blanked the forest. The golden light had cast eerie shadows down the path, we wondered. This was it. We thought we were going to catch her finally. Equipped with our sticks and flashlights and walkie-talkies, we called out, "Black Witch. Come show yourself. Into the shadows." Katie thought if we split into two groups we would cover more ground and find the witch easier. So Katie and myself, being the two oldest of the group, wandered ahead, chanting, "Black Witch, Black Witch, Black Witch, show yourself," in hopes of scaring Debbie and my sister to run home. Katie and myself would crack sticks against trees, rustle leaves, and laugh like we were the witches to mess with Debbie and my sister. The walkie-talkie cracks on, and we hear a scream from the other end, "Help, help. She's got Debbie and me." Laughing to ourselves, Katie jokes, "They are just messing with us, common, let's keep wondering." About 10 minutes later, again, the walkie-talkie cracks on, "Help. She has us." Still laughing at what we thought was a joke, the walkie-talkie beeps, cracks, and makes an ear-splitting hiss. A gut-wrenching laughter comes, though, that is neither Debbie nor my sister's voice. She then speaks, "Oh, children are such tasty treats. Their bones grind into fine paste. Their blood turns into wine. Come find me if you dare." Katie and I panic. "What the heck, Katie, this is not a joke. Who's that voice?" Katie laughs, "It's a joke, trust me, there are no such things as witches. It's a story my mom tells so we won't get lost in the forest. Common, let's go back to your house. I'm sure Debbie and your sister will be there. We probably scared them, and your mom is just playing tricks to scare us to come home." Just then a branch behind us snaps and an evil laugh erupts through the woods. The same voice that came through the walkie-talkie speaks, "Such tasty children you must be." We turn and see a long black cloak darting through the trees and hear Debbie and my sister's screams of fear. The dark cloak moves faster towards us, laughing maniacally. We run and run, zipping back home. Make it through the house crying in fear. To see Debbie and my sister watching a movie. "We thought the Black Witch got you," Katie cries. Debbie and my sister turn to see our tear-soaked faces. "What, we turned around back home when we heard you two trying to scare us," Debbie says. "Then why are you guys screaming on the walkie-talkie that the witch got you?" I cry for them. "Ha ha, yeah, we messed with you too," my sister states matter-of-factly. "Then who was that voice on the walkie-talkie talking about eating children?" we ask. "We lost the walkie-talkie on the way back to the house." "You guys are losing it," Debbie laughs. "We saw her. She came charging through the trees after us. We thought she had you guys. She was coming to eat us," Katie cries. I nod in agreement. "All right, enough with trying to scare us. There's no such thing as the Black Witch," my sister states. We sit down to try and calm down. Then the walkie-talkie snaps on, "Ha ha ha, you girls sure look tasty. Why didn't you want to find me?" In 1982, I and six buddies went bear hunting in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. We stayed in cabins near Twin Lakes, at the base of the Keweenaw Peninsula. When you hunt most critters, you go out before dawn and sit until an hour or two after the sun comes up and late afternoon until dark. Most bigger game animals hunker down during daylight hours, so it doesn't pay to sit all day. This means you have a lot of time between hunts. This part of the up has some remote areas. It is also where a lot of copper mining went on in the old days. The mines are all closed now and mostly full of water. There are a lot of big paper mill holdings there also that are still being logged, so there are a lot of logging roads built by the paper mills. They are good enough roads for large double-trailer log trucks filled with many tons of logs to travel on. One thing you learn quickly when you use these roads is to get the hell off the road when a truck is coming, because they take up the whole road and they don't even slow down for civilians, because the mill owns the roads, not the state or county, and you are on their land, but as long as you don't get in the way, they don't care. Most of the bridges across streams or rivers just consist of huge piles of large rocks with smaller gravel on top of the road. These things look like dams, but because of the large bottom rocks, the water can flow through the bridge. It's a pretty cool thing to see. We spent a lot of time driving and exploring these logging roads. On one particular day, we went down a new road that led to an actual state park at the bottom of Misery Bay on Lake Superior. It's a park maintained by the state on paper mill property. There are several very rustic campsites at that park. We spent some time at the park and messed around on the beach. About noon, we headed back down a different road. You see a lot of small shacks that usually have smoke coming out of the chimneys. They are apparently used by the loggers. We eventually ended up way out in the wilderness with no signs of logging or logging trucks. It's usually like driving in a tunnel because the trees come together over the road. After a long while, we came into a clear area, and around a bend there, we came upon what we thought was a small town. The road basically went right down Main Street, and as we drove through the place, it became apparent there were no people to be seen. We came to a building that was a sort of store, so we stopped there. The store was completely empty. Looking in the dusty windows, you could see it had been empty for a long time. We walked around Main Street checking out the houses. A lot of them were in pretty good repair, but they were completely deserted. Dust on all the floors had been undisturbed for many years, and there were no signs of foot traffic anywhere. We eventually got back in the trucks and moved on. We were all pretty intrigued by the town. We didn't go in any of the houses because it looked like the owners might actually come back. The main street went up a pretty big hill. At the top of the hill was a large building that was obviously some kind of industrial use building covered in that old galvanized corrugated metal sheeting. We stopped at the building and found an opening in the siding. The inside of the building was wide open, and it was very tall, like 30 to 40 feet tall, with a lot of supporting steelwork. Everything was very rusty and obviously hadn't been touched in many years. There were large windows with no glass, just open to the outside high up in the walls that allowed the sun to light it up pretty well inside. At the center of the place, there was a large hole in the floor, like 15 to 20 feet square. We peered down into the opening, and it was a deep, dark hole. Somebody dropped a stone down the hole, and it was a long time before you could hear a faint splash of water, so we dropped a stone, and we had a couple of those old Casio watches with a stopwatch function, so we dropped a rock and timed it to the splash. It took almost exactly 10 seconds. There were no guardrails or safety measures of any kind. It was really scary thinking about falling into that deep black hole. There was some old equipment left that looked to be turn-of-the-century type stuff. We assumed it was a closed copper mine. The whole time we were exploring, we had two 35mm film cameras taking a lot of pictures. This was 30 years before cell phones and 35 to 40 years before smartphones. After exploring the place for a while, we decided it was time to get going because we had only a few hours before dark. After miles of running down those unmarked roads, we finally made it back to the cabins, and we all went out to our hunting spots. After it got dark, we all headed to the local bar, where we usually went to get something to eat. One of the guys asked the lady bartender if she knew anything about that shut-down mine and abandoned the town. She got kind of a funny look on her face and went to the kitchen pass-through window and said, "Hey Dave, these guys went and visited Peterson." We all looked at each other like, "What is she talking about?" The kitchen door opened up, and the cook, apparently called Dave, came out dressed in typical bar cook clothes. Dave came over and said, "What did you see in Peterson?" We said, first of all, we never saw a sign with a name on it, but it was just an abandoned town with pretty decent looking buildings and a closed down copper mine up on the hill. Dave said, "Yep, that's Peterson. Some people see the signs going into town, and some don't. The thing is, there never was a Peterson. It never existed." WHH. "What the duck are you talking about?" We were there, looked into the buildings, dropped rocks down the empty mine shaft, and took many pictures. Dave said, "Yes, you and many other people. But if you try to return, you won't find it." "What?" "We know the road we took. We can get back there," he said. "Go ahead and try. You won't find it." Dave asked, "Did you, by any chance, drop a rock in the hole and time it to the bottom?" "Yes, actually, we did. It took almost exactly 10 seconds. Dave said, "Yes, I did, too, and I looked it up. A falling rock or anything falls about 400 feet in 10 seconds. He said Peterson is a real ghost town. The whole place is a real ghost town. He said I was there and saw the same things years ago, but I've tried many times to go back and I've never been able to find it. Me and a lot of other people who live in this area and know it like the backs of our hands have seen it once and once only. Dave said to go to Houghton Hancock to get your film developed, and let's see the pictures. The next day, we decided to take off from hunting and go up to town and get the film developed. Houghton Hancock is home to Michigan Tech, so it's a college town with all the amenities. It had a quick film developer, so we dropped the film off and went to see the sights. It's a really picturesque place. About an hour northeast of HH is Copper Harbor at the very top of Michigan, where it ends into Lake Superior. It is a really cool place. When we got back to HH, we were dying to see the pictures, so we went and got the film and tore open the envelopes. There were lots of pictures, beautiful pictures, but not a single picture of Peterson. Now, just a goddamn minute, this is not ducking possible. A couple of the guys went back to the film place and asked, where are the other pictures that were on those rolls? There were no other pictures. You have all the negatives. We don't keep other people's pictures. We see thousands every month. There's a park in town, and we stopped there, and all sat at a table, just kind of in shock, not saying much for quite a while. In 1982, I was 23 years old. At 23, you think you know it all when you are hit square in the face by something like that. It shakes you to the core. Everything you think you know is now suspect because you were in that abandoned town. It was just a cool old abandoned town. You saw it with your own eyes in the wide open, sunny, broad daylight, not on some dark, foggy, creepy night, and nothing creepy happened. We took pictures that don't exist. That changed my life from that point forward. After that, we went back to see Dave and gave him the stack of pictures of the woods, the Big Mac Bridge, Misery Bay, the park on the bay, logging trucks, the rock bridges, and some of the shacks, one of which was just about 2 miles from Peterson. Dave just kind of chuckled and said, "Yep, that's our Peterson, all right." For the next 2 days we totally forgot about hunting. We split up in two trucks and drove those roads over and over and over and never refound Peterson. That is my high strangeness story. We found a town that never existed, that other people have also seen but only once. As I look back on what we are now hearing stories about, stuff like different timelines like this ducked up one we are in now compared to the real one we branched off from on January 20, 2016. Is Peterson a place close to a spot where two different timelines come very close together? Is it possible that when all the conditions in the universe are just right and you happen to be in the right place when all those conditions are right, you can visit Peterson? What would happen if you were in Peterson and the universal conditions changed? I wonder if we will ever find out. If you can only go there once, how will it be studied? The mind-warping question is, who keeps track of who has been to Peterson only once and who hasn't? I was in the famous Gary, Indiana church, I'm sure y'all know it, with a friend shooting pics, and a group of teens came through. I told them, "Hey, the upper floors really aren't stable, don't go up there," and they ignored me. About 10 minutes later, we heard a crash. Turns out, the southwestern staircase collapsed as they were barely making it onto the third floor. All of us at the bottom thought one of them had fallen under the rubble, so I rushed in with one of their friends and began digging, only to have to run out a few seconds later because more of the stairs and walls above were collapsed. Turns out, everyone had made it to the third floor before the collapse. The three of them had to be rescued by firefighters an hour later. However, I've never been more scared in a bando than right now, thinking I may have just watched someone be crushed to death by rubble. Lesson here, be very careful where you put your feet when exploring, especially in older buildings without steel supports. You could very well lose your life. They came within a few inches that day. True story. I am a 36-year-old female. I have spent the majority of my life with this memory, and I believe I will stop having the nightmares about it if I share it. So, here we go. I was only 13 years old when this happened to me. I lived in a small town of less than 6,000 people. Living in a cul-de-sac made life easier, in its own way. There were stationary neighbors with day-to-day interactions, so everyone knew everybody. The group of kids that lived on this street consisted of a handful of 7 to 13-year-olds, giving me the advantage of being the oldest at the time. There was one other set of kids that we engaged with at the time, except they were almost always too engrossed in their own world to join us in ours. I had a boundary that kept me from going more than 4 houses away from my own. However, my friends from up the street would come down to me so we could play. I was also supposed to stay out of the woods that were across from my property, but that was just too much for my curious mind. My friends, whom I will call Michael, Shelley, and Connie, came down almost every day to hang out and ride bikes with me. One day, we decided that exploring the woods would be the best adventure we could have in our closed-off neighborhood, as we had already explored every part of the cemetery that stood behind our realm of existence. We had a cool fort that we had built, making sure each of us got to own it for a certain day, so no one felt left out. Getting to the fort meant crossing a small stream by swinging across a vine, and we had enough mishaps with that as time went on that we knew crossing one at a time was our best option. The day finally came that we had two other boys, Craig and Daniel, join us in the woods. They got bored fairly quickly with our limited imaginations that revolved around the creek, suggesting we explore deeper into the woods. Craig was 13, like me, but Daniel was 15 and decided he would be the leader of our rambunctious group. Fearing being left out of an exhilarating adventure, Michael, Connie, Shelley, and I decided we would follow them further into the thicket of trees that had previously blocked our existence. Daniel, who was friends with my older brother, promised he wouldn't let anything undesirable happen. From previous conversations with him, I knew he was scared of my older brother and would result in violence to keep me safe as long as he didn't have to fight my brother, so I was willing to go along. I was worried about my counterparts, however, they all seemed excited and willing, so we set out to see where our imagination would lead us. We traveled further into the woods, trees beginning to grow closer together, shrubbery growing higher, before we were starting to get tired of high-stepping our way around. About the time that I had the idea that I was bored and would rather be swinging over the creek, Daniel called out that he saw something ahead of us. Intrigued, we continued on our path and happened across a cabin. It looked worn down, abandoned, and unwilling to tell its secrets. Of course, this meant I was hooked. We proceeded up the stairs of the cabin, bringing us to the rickety old front porch, the boards creaking as if we were about to fall through at any moment. A few knocks at the door let us know that no one in the vicinity was willing to answer, at the least, and possibly scared of us at the most. Craig and Daniel began shoving on the door, trying to get the worn and weathered wood to budge as everyone anticipated a miraculous sight to be seen. I, on the other hand, was too anxious and started looking around me. I jumped off the porch to the right and decided to follow the barely visible path around the corner of the shack. I had made it about halfway when I heard the front door give in a groaning heap of disgust, and everyone else in my group cheered about obtaining entry to this rusted old shamble that could have been a home once upon a time. I shook my head and continued on my path of discovery when my foot caught something in the leaves that sent me sprawling, screaming out in surprise, until I was face down on the ground. I had tripped over something solid and unmoving. I gathered myself and turned to sit upright on my buttocks, looking at what my foot had uncovered. It was a wooden edge, one that could be construed as a passage, a hidden means to discovery. Leaning forward, up on my knees, I cleared out the leaves and found a hidden door. I knew instantly it was an outside entrance to a basement and was excited at the prospect of figuring out this cabin and what it was used for. I called for everyone else to come outside, however, only Daniel and Shelley came out. Shelley was my closest female friend, and Daniel was the one who was scared of my brother, so I figured I was in good hands at this point. Together, we got the metal latch undone and raised the lid to the inner sanctum of our curiosity. Looking down into that pit of what I could only imagine as despair and ridicule, I know I have a very overactive imagination. I decided I wanted to know more. Daniel wouldn't let me go further, he wanted the first steps into the abyss. I started to argue, but Shelley pulled me back, stating if something was down there, it would go for the first person and the rest could all get away. That was logical, in its own sense, however, I felt whatever needed to be discovered was of my own demise. Daniel convinced me by saying, "Your brother would kill me," and as I wasn't sure if my brother would take it out on me also, I stepped back for him to go down those desolate stairs alone. It took only seconds for us to hear him say, "Wow. Look at this." Before I was down the stairs and standing in only what I could construe as hidden darkness, vaguely hinted for something sinister. It just felt wrong in that enclosed space between me and Daniel. It smelled of must and rot, old boards, and trapped animals that had died. Daniel pulled out a flashlight from his pocket, and I remember slapping his arm because of a thought that crossed my mind. He looked at me in surprise, and I stated, "You've been here before." He looked down and away before looking back at me and asking, "What does it matter?" I shook my head and shoved him forward, saying, "You could have at least told us where we were headed." Part of me was furious that he had led us to somewhere he had engaged himself before, while the other part was beyond curious at maybe finding something he hadn't. His body language changed, relaxing as if he were comfortable, and he strode nonchalantly forward, leaving me observing not only his demeanor but also my surroundings. Shelley called from above to ask of our well-being, and I informed her it was just an empty, dusty cellar and we were going to search the corners. Shelley wasn't a very adventurous person and was very happy with staying above ground as we ventured further. I had taken about 5 steps into the darkness, barely illuminated by the dim, blinking flashlight, when I heard something that sent the hairs on the back of my neck screaming up into my scalp. I focused more on Daniel, watched as his back straightened, and saw his hesitant step back, withdrawing any light from the angle he was headed. It was almost as if he had turned into a statue. "Danny?" My voice was soft, almost a whisper. "What's wrong?" He twitched, almost as if he were about to turn to me, when he went bored straight and didn't make another move. "Danny, this isn't funny. Chris, my brother, won't be happy that you let me come down here." He didn't move. He just stared in the direction he was facing, mumbling something I couldn't understand. Suddenly, without any chance of reacting, Daniel had me in his hands and was shoving me towards the stairs. Shocked, I recoiled and began slapping my hands against his arms, yelling, "What the hell? What are you doing?" He had pushed me up 3 stairs when I heard it. A low, almost resonating groan. Something about it said "help me," while another part of my brain said "get the hell out." I gasped, my body no longer wanting to comply as Daniel shoved as hard as he could to get me out of the basement. He kept yelling, "Go. Go. Get out." While I scrambled to make sense of what was happening. Daniel passed me on the stairs, and I thought I was done for as the searing fear locked me in place, but he reached his hand back and grabbed mine in mid-darkness, yanking up and out as fast as he could. An echoing laughter surrounded us as my back hit the ground and sunlight shone on my face. I was in shock, total disbelief. I couldn't move, even as Shelley yelled above me that we had to go, Daniel trying to drag me from where I lay. Finally, I was able to move again, jumping as quick to my feet as I could manage while Shelley and Daniel yelled, all of us racing to the front of the cabin. We met the rest of our friends coming out of the structure, asking what we were up to, when Daniel yelled, "He's here. Run." Craig didn't hesitate while the rest of my friends turned their heads in confusion. Craig grabbed them and began pushing them to the steps, knocking them down only to pick them up and keep pushing. I knew, in that moment, that Craig and Daniel had encountered this torment before and had led us to a den of danger and strife. It made me mad. I grabbed Shelley and Connie and pulled them as fast as I could through the trees, leaving Michael to Daniel and Craig to pull along. We ran, as fast as teenage and preteen legs could take us, trying to make it back to the creek. We were coming up on a hill, something we had joked about earlier, saying it was easier going down than climbing up, but we found a way to make a quick trip of it. Suddenly, we all froze at the sound of maniacal laughter echoing so very closely behind us. Shelley and Connie started crying, and Michael tried to run to the side. Craig grabbed Michael and yelled "No." While I wrapped my arms as closely around Connie and Shelley as I could and yelled "Keep going." Something, someone, whatever it was after us. We had to make it home. We topped the hill. I let go of the girls to let them stumble and sprint as fast as they could, all of us fighting gravity and nature the best we could. We knew we were in it for our lives. My foot caught a molehill, sending me rolling down the hill, landing in a way that told me I wasn't making it out by myself as my ankle screamed at me to knock it off. I cried out, grabbed my ankle, and started mumbling in shock. "Please, no, please, I have to make it." Daniel scooped me up as if I were a feather, Craig suddenly grabbing my left arm. I felt as if I were flying, knowing it was just the two boys that had lifted me up and were carrying me forward. I tried to help, being awkward and my ankle not cooperating. We settled in the bottom of the valley and began navigating up the creek to find our comfort zone. It was about the time that we had decided to cross the creek that I heard a familiar voice call my name. "Dad," I yelled out, as quickly as I could move my mouth. Within seconds, my dad and brother broke through a line of bushes, grabbing me from Craig and Daniel, pulling me to them as my friend's parents suddenly were visible and pulling them close. Tears streamed down my cheeks, my voice trembling and unable to make a coherent statement. Daniel stepped forward to try to explain, but what we didn't anticipate was a scream from the woods, one that sent everyone in our group, kids and adults alike, rolling back as if they had been slapped. We all listened as it echoed around us, banking off the trees and falling into the creek. My dad looked at me, shook his head, and said, "Never again." Our parents led us out of those woods, taking us home. One by one down the street, we dishearteningly shuffled as our parents let each person know along the way that the woods were no longer a place we could play. Eventually, I was safe. In my home. Confused, but okay. Except. What was out there? Who wanted us in that basement? What was wrong with him, or her? It took years to form, but a darkness seated in my brain, the curiosity of that single day, that moment in time. As I grew older, each day without an answer has driven me to try to figure out what exactly is in our world and always wonder. Why? My friend lives in Nelson, Nebraska. The town is small, and it has some abandoned houses and buildings. My friend and his girlfriend decided to go exploring one night and took me along with them. They practice take only pictures, leave only footprints. There is an abandoned old folks' home there. When the building closed, things were left behind. Some rooms still had beds in them along with some personal items. One room still had a dresser with a watch, a billfold, and coins. It was late night, pitch black in the home and quiet like the dead. I took four flashlights because I'm scared of the dark and I'm not going to be stuck standing in the darkness crying like a little girl. You've seen the horror movies where the flashlight flickers and then goes dark, not happening with me. We wandered around and found a patient's room with only a Christmas tree fully decorated with tinsel standing in the center of the room. The weird part was the tinsel was floating on the tree and flickering. The really weird part was that the home had no electricity or AC. But yet the tinsel moved as if blowing in a slight breeze. Freaky. We found the kitchen. It was filled with stainless steel countertops and white walls. Something with fingers was growing in the big refrigerator. They left in a hurry. I opened my mouth and broke the silence and said, "I'm fixing on cooking breakfast." All of a sudden there was a noise in the dark over there. Three beams of light jumped at where the sound came from, nothing. So I said something about eggs and bacon, again another sound from the other side of the kitchen closer this time. The flashlights turned to nothing. Every time I mentioned a food type, the sounds were starting, surrounding us. I said Brussels sprouts, crickets, nada, the sound stopped. I said to my friends it was time to go. After all, I woke up something, and I couldn't even put the smell of breakfast in the air. We left and went back home to watch the video Emma took. In it, the reflection of sets of eyes could be seen on the video blinking and following us. Very disconcerting. We didn't see any of that with our eyes, but the video picked it up. The night was fun, a little scary, but for the most part fun. I'll be visiting my buddy again soon. He says there's a house where the people who lived there just bailed in the middle of dinner. I'll let you know how that goes. In high school, some friends and I really enjoyed exploring abandoned buildings in the small city I was in, and climbing occupied buildings. We generally went as a group of 3 to 5. Two people didn't feel safe enough, and six felt like we made too much noise and would get caught. These two experiences happened when I decided to go with only one other person. The first experience was my junior year of high school when a close friend and I decided to go to a 5-story warehouse and cotton mill compound at around 9 p.m. in the late fall. The majority of the night was uneventful, and I really liked this place because it was big and open, and you could generally see to the other side of the warehouse, 300 to 400 feet, on each floor. However, on the third floor, there was an office building, and in the basement, a very damp, dark, and cramped storage area. We wandered the first floor for about 45 minutes before going to the basement, because there were generally cool signs that we could snag to decorate our rooms. The entire time we were down there, I felt like there was someone behind us peering out from around corners and through the fences dividing the storage areas, but every time I turned around, we were very much alone. I never heard anything, just that feeling. I didn't say anything because I didn't want to seem scared for no reason, so we continued without any actual incident and moved to the second and then third floors. The third floor is one I generally steer clear of because of how claustrophobic it made me feel. In the darkness, with only two flashlights to reveal the surroundings. The office spaces were laid out with one long hallway running the short side of the building and multiple long hallways coming off this running the length of the building. These long hallways had small square rooms on either side, and the white walls were covered in spray paint tags, quotes, and artworks. As my buddy walked into one of these rooms, I once again had this strange feeling, and I turned around, shining my light back down the hallway and looking into the short corridor we had just come from. As I did this, I saw a shadow at the right side of the doorway and watched it quickly dart left, across the doorway, and deeper into the building, away from the stairs. I immediately called out to my friend and told him what I saw. He thought I was messing around and trying to scare him. I told him no, because we had a rule that we don't scare others while exploring because someone might get hurt. We tend to lash out when scared. Convinced that I had actually seen something, we left as quickly as we could, and I explained the feeling I had when we were in the basement, which he stated he had felt as well, but didn't want to seem scared either. I still don't know what or who it was. It still creeps me out because my flashlight was the only light source there. This floor has no windows, and it was a distinct shadow from my flashlight, though I never saw anything to create the shadow, even though it crossed in front of the light. The second experience was at an abandoned grain plant a few miles outside of town. The building is about 18 stories tall, has a small office space connected to the bottom, and is surrounded by massive 10-story cone-shaped buildings, which I think were silos, but we could never really figure out what they were exactly. I was with my girlfriend, and she really wanted to go exploring with me, so we decided to go there that night. When we arrived, the area already felt weird because it was bright and everything had a brownish tint to it. Even though it was midnight, we hadn't pulled out the flashlights yet, and there was no moon that night. I just decided that our eyes were adjusted to the darkness and moved on. As we walked the 2-ish football field access road to the plant, it became eerily quiet, no wind or movement of any kind. The only sound we heard was the leaves under our feet. Once we got to the overgrown parking lot and loading docks at the base of the building, we stood and stared up at the tower and hesitated. She turned to me and said that she didn't feel right about this. I told her she wasn't alone because I had a feeling of dread about going up, even though I only had fun and happy experiences here, even late at night. We decided to go home and watch movies instead, and we both still believed that if we had gone up there that night, something terrible would have happened. I must insist that I am an adrenaline junkie and normally do not shy away from these experiences, but for some reason that night I had the urge to turn and run. I don't know if a stair would have given out on the exterior of the tower, 10 plus stories off the ground, or if someone/something malicious was waiting up top, but I am glad I spent the night watching movies and eating microwave popcorn instead. So, in my late teens, I had this friend, let's call him Felix. Unlike my social anxiety-ridden self, he was a social butterfly and appeared to know everyone. As such, I ended up knowing a lot of people by proxy and hung out with some interesting folk. The one I am going to talk about below is named Carly. I'm not 100% convinced, but she might be a real-ass witch. I was at Felix's place one night with a few people, and we were all playing a game of Risk. We had smoked a bit and got to talking about some weird topics, compounded by the fact that we were weird teens. You know, the usual. My buddy had crazy stories about getting stuck in a radio tower, another friend had stories about getting locked in a basement all night. I had my ghost stories, and it was one of the few times people believed me, so that was nice. Carly was the one we called bullshit on the most. Carly was your typical edgy goth girl, complete with clothes that would put a stripper to shame and enough makeup that it had a noticeable thickness. She was hot, I'd admit that, but we were distant friends, and I had hung out with her a few times with Felix. She seemed charming enough, if a bit emotionally reserved. Well, this night she wakes up and states that she's an energy vampire. I had no idea what that was, as I didn't really have access to a lot of internet in rural Newfoundland. She goes on to say that she gets energy from people's emotions, she can feel people's auras, she can detect when people have issues, and she has to keep her emotions in check because she can get powerful. Me and Felix call bullshit, as we had never seen her be powerful, and those kinds of claims reek of fake coming from the edgy goth kid. She goes on and does reading, where she is able to tell me about my emotions. I remember she rightly said I was depressed, but that isn't much of a shocker to anyone who met me and told Felix he had a grave injury impending. His mom did have a stroke like a year later, for what little that might be worth. She also said some other vague things to the rest of the people we were hanging out with, which were probably correct, but I cannot confirm. Finally, after this had gone on for an hour or so, I called her bluff. I asked where she got these mystical powers. I remember asking if her dad was a warlock and her mom a pixie. She says she was taught by Mother Hilda. That was the most bullshit name I ever did hear, and I said, where the hell does she live? Up your ass. Becoming visibly distressed, she said to me and Felix, who was laughing his ass off, that she could bring me to her next weekend. Thinking she would bring me to one of her weird goth friends who would try some edgy shit and always down for a laugh, I of course said yes. Felix was down as well, so it was settled. Now, it's important to know that I have an issue with being a passenger in cars. I fall asleep almost immediately when not driving, a holdover from long car trips with the family. I mean, I sleep immediately, if I can make it 5 minutes, it's a miracle. It's really important to remember this, because I sure as shit wish it wasn't the case. So when the weekend comes, me, Felix, and Carly all get together to go meet this person. I had assumed it would be someone we would meet in the basement of their parents' house, but Carly says that Mother Hilda lives on the Bonavista Peninsula. That's a good 3-hour drive and good weather from where I lived, and I was frankly more pissed off that she didn't bring snacks. So we all got in her car, she had gotten her license already since she was 6 months older than us, and we set off. In my true fashion, I fell asleep within minutes, and I don't think we even hit the highway before I was out. When I had woken up, we were driving on a dirt road in the middle of nowhere. For those of you who haven't been to Newfoundland, I think my wife put the Bonavista Peninsula best. It's like you're walking on the graves of a million really pissed off ghosts. Gloomy skies, gloomy landscapes, and a real feeling that something is watching you from the treeline where you can't see them. I frankly hate the place, most people I know from it are great, but everyone I know who lives on it is miserable. So I come to, and we are driving down this poor excuse for a road, and what could be more aptly named a goat path. So I immediately start complaining, where the hell are we, why are we here, and what are you planning? You know, reasonable questions. To all of the questions she answered, Mother Hilda will answer like a psychopath. Felix doesn't say a word and just looks mildly amused. So after what felt like forever, we come to some kind of clearing. It is really just a place where the trees aren't that big. In the middle sat an old school Newfoundland box house in absolutely horrible condition. Like, no one had shown this house a lick of love in 100 years run down. It still had windows, given, but the roof looked like it was attempting to threaten the ground with its lean. I remember the place was blue and the goat path didn't reach all the way up to it. It stopped about 100 feet shy, because of course it did. Carly stops the car, gets out, and, like a psychopath, says again, "Mother Hilda will answer." I look to Felix, who has the biggest grin on his face. He's high as a kite. I berate him, as this shit is ducking horrifying, and his only real response getting out of the car is, "You're a better man than me for doing this sober." So, I get out of the car with Felix, who insists I go first. My only thought is, I'm going to be murdered. Carly walks through the trees with her arms outstretched in a T pose, spinning and singing, "Mother Hilda knows all." Felix looks at me and says, "We're getting ducking murdered, aren't we?" Carly reaches the door, opens it up, and motions for us to come in. Now, I saw two options. Either go in with the witchy woman or brave the untamed wilderness of rural Newfoundland in God knows where. I decide later, as that one only has a chance that I die and no one finds the body. I reach the door, and it is pitch black inside. It was a generally overcast day outside, and the windows must have been covered in paper or something. Not freaking furnished, no lighting, just rotting boards and the smell of my impending doom. I can hear Carly laughing upstairs, because of course there's an upstairs. So I think, yep, I die here. This is a murder house for her weird rituals. I can tell Felix is thinking the same thing but insists I go first. Thankfully the stairs were next to the front door, so I didn't have to risk walking through that creepy place. When I looked up the stairs, I nearly pissed myself. At the top is a girl butt-ass naked and pointing down the upstairs hallway. She has makeup like Carly, thick and dark, and is staring at us with intent, possibly murderous, eyes. I turn to look back at Felix when the girl at the top of the stairs belts out, in a voice louder than I'd peg her to have, "Mother Hilda doesn't wait." So, petrified, I walk up those stairs. The place was eerily silent. I hadn't really noticed it before, but there was no sound of the wind in the trees, no birds chirping, no rustling, and no floorboard creaking. I started to really get those murder vibes on strong, but Felix flashed me a hunting knife he brought along and whispered, "I got you. We're leaving alive." Feeling 0.1% better, I reached the top of the stairs. The girl, who was maybe 14, ran into a room on the upper floor, and I saw Carly at the end of the hall next to a door, what I assumed to be a closet. She had the biggest grin on her face, like a proud child about to show their mom a Play-Doh figure they had worked on all day. I walked closer, and with all the manly gusto I had in me, I made it 5 steps in the hallway. I had the feeling I was going to puke, and every fiber in my being was telling me whatever was behind that door was danger, pure danger. Carly looked at me and said, "Mother Hilda will see you and open that door." What was inside was what I believed to be a small child, its back turned to me and eating something in the closet. I remember seeing chicken bones at its feet, which were huge by the way. It was wearing a ratty red shawl and was ass naked below the waist. And that's when I noticed it was an old person. It had that typical saggy old person ass, the one that lacks all tone and definition. I watched this thing turn around, and it was the scariest sight of my life. It was some kind of old woman, but I questioned that frequently given its appearance. It had tiny, tiny arms like an infant on a toddler's body that was holding her shawl up. It had wispy angelic strands barely holding onto its head and a noticeable hump on its back. I assume I noticed this because its face didn't make sense. It was teeth, just one big mouth with hundreds of misshapen teeth. The entire face looked like it had been scooped out and just given teeth, rows upon rows of teeth. I saw no eyes, no nose, no forehead, just long, creepy teeth. It snarled and yelled, "No men." And I passed the duck out. When I woke up, I was back in Felix's house, him already up and staring at the floor with a 1,000-yard stare. I asked him if I ducking had some kind of weird dream, and without missing a beat, he says, "Mother Hilda is a real man. I thought it was a creepy fake thing. But I saw it too." We talked for about 30 minutes about what happened, and we had basically the same recollection of events, except Felix saw her move a step or two before he blacked out. I said I should go home, he said I should leave, we both went our separate ways. Over the next few days I tried to message Carly, back in the days of MSN Messenger, but the only response I ever got was "Mother Hilda never forgets." After 3 days of this, about 10 messages a day, I said, "Duck Carly, I didn't need that in my life." Never hung out with her again, although I did see her from time to time in school, but she refused to look at me. I had only one more encounter with Mother Hilda, whatever the hell she is, past that. I had quite a big yard before the river and had a sizable fire pit where I would have fires. Having Felix as my only real friend, I had many bonfires alone. That was fine, I enjoyed the spectacle of it all. So one night I was having a fire, and I started to get really into it. Flames went maybe 15 feet high, and I was having a great time. I had whipped off my shirt, placed it on the 6-foot poking stick I had, and began chanting in gibberish. I don't know why, but it was a conscious action, teenagers are weird. On the other side of the fire, through a line of trees, was a small path my neighbor had to follow to the woods. I catch a glossé out of the corner of my eye, something small in the trees. Thinking it could be a wild cat or maybe a baby bear, I stop to look at it. From the other side of the line of trees, I see Mother Hilda, her gaping maw wide open and facing in my direction. I go to scream, as is a logical action, but Mother Hilda yells no. And my raging inferno goes out. Not even an ember stayed lit, a cold, dead fire. I looked back, no, Mother Hilda. I decide that is enough, and I book it into my house as fast as my legs can go. When I get inside, my mom asks me why I'm not having the fire anymore. She rarely cared what I did, so I asked why she wanted to know. My mom said that the lovely girl who wears black asked about me maybe 5 minutes ago at the front door. Mom had told her I was having a fire, and she started to walk to the backyard. I go to my room, horrified, and message Carly on MSN to demand what the hell. I shouldn't have gotten an answer since she had just been at my door, but I did. Mother Hilda likes you. I haven't really told anyone this story before now, as it is one of my more outlandish ones, but my friend Felix still won't talk about it. I met him a while ago when I traveled back to Newfoundland and asked him if he remembered Carly and the creepy house. He just looked at me with dead eyes and said, "Mother Hilda is a real man. Don't duck around," and deadass walked away. I still have yet to make sense of it, like a lot of things that happen to me. I want to establish that I come into contact with many strange things. While some of those things could be considered paranormal, most of them have a logical explanation, or at least that is what I tell myself. With that being said, don't believe that the story that I'm about to tell you is anything paranormal, but this experience was quite unsettling. I am going to start by telling you a little bit about myself. I love running. I never really liked any team sports like soccer or basketball because I am severely introverted, but I needed to get PE credits to graduate from high school, so I decided to join a cross-country and track team. While there was practice with the team almost every day, I would usually do my own independent practice on a bike trail that I lived really close to. I loved that bike trail, and I spent a lot of my free time running, walking, and biking on it, as well as wandering off the trail to explore the beautiful forest that surrounds it. Despite this bike trail being 67 miles long, it was very well kept, or at least the part that I used was. The bike trail was a huge circle and was split into multiple sections that each had checkpoints at the end of them. The section that I used most of the time was roughly 8 miles from the checkpoint I lived next to the next one. I rarely ever walked or ran the full 16 miles, but they say that this story took place when I decided that I would attempt it for the first time. The run started off like any other. I put my AirPods in and started to play my running music. It was a nice, cool day, and the first 3 miles went amazingly. Being that it was such a nice day for using the trail, there were quite a few other bikers and runners using it, but I really only saw them for the first 3 or 4 miles of the segment. This is because at about 4 miles into that segment there was a 2-mile trail that went off the main trail and led to a popular campground, so that is where most of the runners and bikers that I saw came from, and they would usually be going in the direction that I came from to get to the town that I lived in. I say all of this to explain why there was nobody else around when I made an unsettling discovery. I was about 5.5 miles into the trail when something about 100 feet off the trail caught my eye. It didn't look like anything strange at first and was just a white object behind a tree. As I got closer, I realized what it was, and what I saw was extremely unsettling. It was a dollhouse placed behind a tree, and on that tree there were a bunch of pictures of a little boy taped to it. All of the pictures seemed to be taken in a daycare, and the child didn't appear to be having a particularly good or bad time at the daycare. What I mean is the pictures didn't seem concerning and were taken with the boy clearly aware that they were being taken. As for the dollhouse, it is actually a dollhouse, but that is what I call it whenever I tell the story. It was something you'd see in an old woman's garden and was more of a large porcelain decoration than a child's dollhouse. It was a very strange sight, and suddenly I felt as though I was being watched and had a feeling of dread that I had only felt a few times before this moment came over me. I considered taking a picture of it with my phone, but I was scared that if I was really being watched, whoever it was would not appreciate me doing so. I decided that the best thing I could do was to take a good look at the little boy in the picture and try my best to remember his face, so I could look up a list of missing people in the area and see if he was one of them. I walked back onto the trail and decided that I would cut my run short and head back. The feeling of being watched continued until I got close to the offshoot trail that led to the campground, and the rest of the way back was fine. When I got home, I looked up missing people, and none of them appeared to match the boy that I saw in the picture. I continued to check almost every day for the next couple weeks but never found anyone that looked even close to him. I heavily considered going to the police about it, but I didn't have any proof of it, so after about 2 weeks, I decided that I would bike back to the spot where I found the pictures and dollhouse and take a picture of it. I got back to the spot where I'm almost certain that I found them, but there was nothing there. I looked around the area but found nothing. While I was looking around, there was no feeling of dread, and as far as I know, there was no one watching me. I returned home and mostly forgot about it and only brought it up in conversations about weird things I have seen. For all I know, it wasn't anything bad, but it was in the middle of nowhere, and I felt as though there was someone watching me. The thing that scares me the most was that once I discovered it, whoever put it there second to get rid of it or move it somewhere else, which to me confirms that there was actually someone watching me on the day that I discovered it.